The crisis in Brazil is going from bad to worse. And unlike other countries, the virus is killing many children. Some doctors blame an extreme immune response to the virus, multi-system inflammatory syndrome. Critics point to government mismanagement for the second highest COVID death toll in the world.
Doctors Without Borders calls it a humanitarian catastrophe. It says authorities' refusal to adopt evidence-based public health measures has sent far too many to an early grave.
Thalia Gomez starts her day early. She gets up at around 4 a.m., worried about having enough food for her four children to have breakfast.
I wake up with a feeling of being in agony. I jump out of bed and the first thing I do is thank God I'm alive. I look at my children and think to myself, today I'll bring home some food for them. I leave the house early to fetch bread. There are days when I can't manage to bring them any, but they run out overnight.
Gomez lives in a favela of around 100,000 people in Sao Paulo. Here and across Brazil, unemployment hit a record high last year. This community association helps people living in marginalized areas to find work.
We had an 84% increase in demand for employment. After the government's emergency aid ended, the number of people seeking our help tripled because so many people didn't have any support anymore.
In December, government aid of around 84 euros a month was cut, making an already difficult situation for many much worse. The number of people living on less than 36 euros more than doubled. Many families stopped cooking with gas and started using firewood. 27 million Brazilians live in extreme poverty. Renato Tardelli has been researching the favelas for 20 years. All the data shows that the poorer you are, the higher the rate of infection. The more on the periphery the person finds themselves, the higher the death rate from coronavirus. Brazil has added 2 million more people to the marginalized areas in the past year. It's not ethical that Brazilians have to choose between going hungry or getting the virus. It's unethical. Four adults live in the home of Silvia de Jesus. She's a cook and the only one still to have a job. But it's just one day a week. She used to cook in other people's homes, but they let her go for fear of infection.
This pandemic is difficult. It's going to leave all of us starving. And that's apart from all the damage it does to your health. Look at this queue. We're all in the same boat, though.
With a shortage of vaccines and hospitals overwhelmed, it's hard to see a way forward for people in the lowest social groups who are trapped by both poverty and disease.
So life's become even more of a struggle for many Brazilians. Mani Nicolai is from Doctors Without Borders. Just how catastrophic is the situation in Brazil?
Yeah, the situation is really bad. And so the MSF teams are working worldwide in 70 countries. We have supported health facilities in the response to COVID. And in the beginning, it was difficult everywhere. What we see now, a year after, that the situation is still very, very catastrophic in Brazil. And our teams, together with the staff on the ground, is overloaded with patients. They don't have, for instance, the drugs to intubate people, to give them the right anesthesia. So we have images where nurses are sitting on the ground next to people dying because they don't have enough beds, they don't have enough oxygen, they don't have enough medicines to treat the people properly. So it puts an immense pressure on the whole healthcare system, but especially on the staff as well. And people are dying. The numbers that we have of deaths every day is unprecedented.
Let's just run through some of those numbers, Miney, because out of a population of 211 million, there are about 14 million official cases, close to 66,000 confirmed infections every day. And to put it into perspective, The death toll globally has passed 3 million. Over 500,000 of those in the US, in Brazil, about 375,000. Why such a poor record?
Yeah, well, this is the right question, and you've put the numbers on the screen, so this is exactly why we have taken the microphone to speak out about this, because there's no coordinated response. We don't stop this pandemic in the intensive care units. You have to have actions in the population. As we all know in Europe and elsewhere, that we have to do things, not only vaccinate, but we have to put measures like wearing masks, keeping physical distance, reduce non-essential mobility, do testing and contact tracing. All these things are not done in a coordinated way in Brazil, and the health authorities are not putting themselves behind this. And it's scientific. It's knowledge that we have constructed over the last year, and it's not being implemented and used.
Is Brazil's leader at fault here in this case?
Well, we are not pointing at one individual. It's the authorities. It's the federal government and it's the health authorities. Local governments, we work very well on local level, and the people there are overloaded as well. They're crying out for help. We need a plan. We need a good plan that is implemented. And we're not asking for very complicated issues. It is common knowledge nowadays that you need a package of elements to implement those to try to stop the transmission. Look at the numbers you put on the screen every day, the number of people that are getting infected, and the health structures cannot cope. In a country as Brazil, because Brazil is not one of the poorest countries in the world, it has a very good system in place normally, but it's collapsing.
What's your explanation then for COVID killing so many young Brazilians, including babies?
Yeah, we don't have a good explanation for that. So we're also looking into this together with other scientists. What exactly is it that makes it? Of course, there are new forms of the virus in Brazil as well. So we have new mutants of the virus. If you don't have a collective response that we're asking for, we see here the funerals. There is a collapse of places to bury people. It's horrible. If you speak to Brazilians, everybody has somebody that has died or is being interviewed. But the point of the children, we cannot yet completely explain. There are new mutants. If you don't have a collective response, you give the virus the possibility to create, to escape the system and to survive. But the new mutants do not just explain the situation. If we compare it to Southern Africa, for instance, where we also have new mutants, they have vaccinated less people proportionally than in Brazil, but they are reducing their peak because they've put other measures in place. So the mutants don't explain the situation in Brazil, and we need a public health plan.
Really briefly, this multi-system inflammatory syndrome, or MIS, which is being blamed for some of these deaths amongst children, is that what could be the main cause?
Yeah, this is something, this is not for us to comment on as Doctors Without Borders. This is very technical. The right researchers have to look into this. I wouldn't like to make any, hypothesis and estimations on it. It's dreadful that young children drive the disease as well in Brazil. The whole population is suffering. All families are. And what we are calling for is stop the disease in the communities by doing the right things. And we know what we need to do.
We'll have to leave it there. Mighty Nikolai from Doctors Without Borders. Great to have you on the show today.
White supremacy is the sickness.
Katherine Massey, Book Club, The Context of White Supremacy. Today's date, Thursday, February 9, 2022. So I have been told this is our fifth installment on Mário Filho's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. We are picking up section 2.3, chapter 2, the third section. Man, the audio segment that we started with, COVID-19 in Brazil. Now, we heard lots of cows listeners for it's been 3 years, right, of this global pandemic who said that, questioned whether or not the COVID-19 situation is authentic. And certainly many people around the world have had questions and suspicions and all of that. Man, what is the assessment then, if COVID-19 is fake, what is the assessment of Brazil? Because, wow, I mean, I talked about that way back when this first started. They were saying how things are really bad here in the States and so many people died. They were saying the whole time it has been awful in Brazil. Things were awful before, and this just made it way worse. Now, that report was from DW News, German media outlet, and that was also from 2022, just, you know, full transparency, from April 2022, so basically a year ago. And that is important not just because I said I was going to include information about COVID-19 in Brazil this week, because last week we concluded street urchins and all of that, but specifically they talked about tuberculosis. And Filho said that black people, non-white people in Brazil, were the most likely to die from tuberculosis. Now, he was talking 100 years ago. TB continues to be a problem. And I mean, now you can add COVID-19 on top of that. Comorbidities, as they say. And children, did you hear that? We've been talking this whole book, street urchin this and street urchin that and street urchin this and city of God, street urchin, street urchin, street urchin, and COVID-19's impact on. Now, they didn't say it, but I mean, for real, favelas, black children in Brazil. Street urchins, no surprise there at all. The other important point, many news outlets credit Bolsonaro's response or lack thereof to the COVID-19 pandemic as being a major factor in why he lost the election. And then we had all that hooliganism at the beginning of the year. And we heard another installment of starvation that was in the DW segment, talking about COVID-19 and all of this disruption and people losing their jobs and health impact and all of that. Now we don't even have food to eat. Now, have we heard that in a cow's book before? Black people starving. We will keep all of that in mind as we proceed. Again, Mario Filho's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. Audio segment number one, outstanding work from our narrator.
Chapter 2, Part 3. And perhaps there, in the excuse for a loss, was the explanation of everything, of the superiority of the players from the big clubs, players who had family. Family meant a good home and good food. The advantage of having a home, of eating well, was one thing, but there was also the advantage of knowing how to read and write, which many people thought was much more important. The best players really were students, and if they were not students, they were employed in business, set up well in life, all knowing how to read and write. When time came to sign the score sheet, one could see the difference right away. The medical students of Flamengo wrote their names quickly. The workers of Carioca took a lifetime to scribble their names. Some broke into a cold sweat, trembling, thinking that they would never be able to sign their names in front of everyone. And they had to sign their names more than 1,000 times. From Friday through Sunday, every small club would arrange a teacher, but only to teach soccer players to sign their names. When a player in an empty lottery club in the suburbs was discovered, he knew how to play soccer, but he did not know how to read and write. On Andarai, Anacleto, a mulatto player who knew his letters, would take charge of the player, locking himself up with him. All the player had to do was sign his name, to accustom his hand to writing it by tracing the letters. Anacleto would write the player's name, then have him trace it in pencil. The player would only pick up a pen when he had learned how to draw his name in pencil from the first to the last letter. It was one thing, however, to draw one's name in a room, almost alone, Anacleto looking the other way, and another thing entirely to sign the score sheet with many people around watching closely. locked up in a room with a player, one could err many times before getting it right. It didn't matter if one made a mistake. If, however, one erred on the score sheet, everything was lost. The club would lose points, and the league would call him in for an exam, giving him a primer to read. There were some players who could not sign that score sheet no matter what. It seemed they had learned, but in the moment they forgot, and the club would need to arrange for another to go on field. There were players who, in order to learn, had to change their names, as in the case of Pascoal. Horacio Warner of Rio de Janeiro saw Pascoal playing on Municipal's field in Saúde. Municipal was the club of Old Ironsides, Antonio a club of the docks. They organized players of the informal games in Saúde, sometimes good players like Pascoal. Pascoal did nothing else. He spent the day with a ball at his feet, managing to draw a crowd to watch him playing with the ball. He would stop the ball on his foot, holding it, the ball trapped, as if it were tied to his foot. Then he would move his foot up and down, the ball moving as well, without falling on the ground. It only fell when he got tired of it. Otherwise, he could stay like that all day, playing and not letting the ball fall on the ground. Horacio Werner did not need to know anything else. He grabbed Pascoal, took him to Rio de Janeiro, filled out a signing slip, then gave the slip to Pascoal to sign. It was then that Pascoal informed him that he did not know how to write. Horacio Werner had to use the same process as Anacleto. He signed Pascoal's name, simplifying the letters, and he ordered Pascoal to trace the name 1,000 times. It didn't work. Pascoal's last name, that of an Italian fishmonger from Saúde, was Sinelli. The only way to have Pascoal successfully sign was to give him a more modest last name, more common, with fewer letters and no double letters to trip him up. Horacio Warner found nothing better than Silva. Pascoal remained Pascoal Silva from that moment on. With his true name, he would not have gone beyond a player in Saúde. From this, one could see the importance of knowing how to sign one's name. This importance was exaggerated by the cult of the student. There was naturally a reason for this cult. Flamengo won 2 consecutive championships, those of 1914 and 1915, with a team made up almost entirely of medical students. The other big clubs, Fluminense, América, and Botafogo, had students, but not in such an overwhelming proportion. 9 medical students and 1 law student. The more students on a team, the better. This seemed to prove that only students should play. Those who were no longer students thought immediately of abandoning soccer, as in the case of Borgert. He graduated at the end of 1914, and to play in 1915 was tough, when he was no longer a student. His family, which had never said anything about his playing before, began to say things, considering it a scandal that a doctor would go running around after a ball as if he were still a student. Alberto Borgert thus had to change his name because old Borgert on Mondays would read the sports pages of the newspaper attentively to find out if his doctor son still allowed himself the pleasure of playing soccer. There was always a name that deceived him in its first letters, Borges or Borgia. The soccer columnists had answered Borgert's appeal. They no longer wrote in the lineup of Flamengo, either Alberto or Borgert. The readers who had gone to the match may not have even noticed the changed name, and if they did, they would put the blame on faulty editing. Borges and Borgia were printed only for one reader, old Borgert. Thus, Alberto Borgert could play the whole year of 1915 and become a champion again, prolonging his good times as a student when he was so connected to soccer. When he knew he wanted to become a doctor, he would take the pulse of the players before and after the training sessions and games, just to check something. The players allowed him to do it as a joke, but they didn't believe in it, despite the fact that they, too, were studying to be doctors. Alberto Borchardt ended up stopping in order not to seem pedantic. The study of medicine was of no help to the players of Flamengo. The college had merely the virtue of establishing between them the camaraderie that was so indispensable to a soccer team, almost all of them studying together. The college did not interrupt the life of the club. On the contrary, the college became an extension of the club, or the club of the college. Not a single player on Flamengo spent a day without meeting with the others, whether at the club, the college, or Lama's restaurant. On some mornings, they would take a boat trip, then take a dip in the sea. The sea was one more pretext to do a run, from the garage to the Hotel Central, then back. Nobody took any notice, as the Flamengo players looked like bathers, dressed similarly to everyone else, with tight shorts that reached to the knee. They ran early in the morning, so as not to have to run in the afternoon at Russell, the field they rented. They were ashamed to run on that field, which was not theirs. The shame only disappeared when Flamengo, in 1915, received its field on Paysandú Street. Then everything they did in there was fine, and nobody had a problem with it. In 1914, through the beginning of 1915, Russell Field was used only for kicking the ball around. They would have a kick around almost every day. After classes, the players would go to the club. From the club to Russell was just a hop, skip, and a jump. The street urchins at Russell Field, already used to them, did not get in their way anymore. They emptied the field but stuck around to spy, to learn. In this way, time passed swiftly. On Wednesday afternoons, the Flamengo team did not show up at Russell. Instead, they would go to Campos Sales to train with America. People would be lined up all along the barrier, making it seem like a game day. Flamengo would always lose, so as not to put America's goodwill to the test, who had been so genteel, showing such camaraderie to Flamengo. No club but America had remembered Flamengo, though all of them knew Flamengo had no field to train on. Training at Russell on a little nothing field was a good enough place for boys to play. Flamengo had lost two championships. For this reason, the team made a point of not beating America in the training sessions, and also to leave America with the sweet illusion that they would be the 1914 champions. At night, the meeting would be at Lama's restaurant, for a little game of billiards, a chat, and the famous ham and eggs. Sometimes, to change things up, they'd have café au lait with bread and butter, the same café au lait with bread and butter as the Andarai players in the Plaza Sete pub, the difference being that the Andarai players practically lived off of that café au lait. That was not true of the Flamengo players, far from it. When they went to Lama's, they had already eaten lunch and dinner, and were well fed. If they ate ham and eggs at Lama's, or drank café au lait, it was only so they were not eating nothing in a dining establishment. It was only to eat more. The truth is, they could not live separate. Wherever they might be, at the club, the college, Lama's, there was still another meeting place, the Pindaru, an Amarante boarding house, a family establishment on Correa Dutra Street. The evenings at the boarding house of Pindaru and Amarante, called that because they lived there, were special occasions, often on the eve of a game. The players would hear music in a pleasant atmosphere, as if they were at home. Antonio Fonseca would go to the piano, while Angelo Pinheiro Machado plucked the violin. the players would distract themselves, surrounded by young ladies, each one wishing to flirt with one of them. The next day, those young ladies would be in the grandstand, biting their lace handkerchief, letting out little screams, rooting for the victory of Flamengo. Flamengo almost always won, which was, for the young ladies of the Pindaru and Amarante boarding house, the natural order of things. With a team like that, made up of 9 medical students, 1 law student, plus a Gallo, any club would be used to winning, to lifting championship cups. The Flamengo players, however, knew the real reason for their wins. A bit of it had to do with what the young women thought, because they were lads of society, students. But it wasn't because they studied, because they were doctors. It was because, being lads of society, they had everything. Home, food, and clothes washed and starched. And time. Time to study, to play soccer, to live that life. Everybody together, as if they belonged to the same family, as if they were brothers. The club was serving the role of a second home, the of Flamengo, of America, of Fluminense, served as a common line of ancestry. The players were brothers, the members, cousins, the fans, distant relatives, but relatives still. At least they felt as if they were. On weekdays, the club would gather together the closer relatives, the brothers and the cousins. On game days, the whole family. The rich relatives, doing well in life, would be in the grandstand. The poor relatives in general admission, even on the barrier. This was the secret of the club's strength. For this reason, the clubs with championship ambitions wanted to be more than the second home of the players. They wanted to be the true home, the true family. Even when they were not, like Flamengo, they were an extension of the college, a meeting place for classmates. Consider the case of America in 1916, consisting of a medical student, Ferreira, a linotypist at the Correo de Manja, Paulino, a student in the Naval War School, de Pava, 3 agronomists, Ademir, Oscar, and Ojeda, the only classmates studying together in Pinheiros, an industrialist, Vidi, an employee of the telegraph company, Paula Ramos, an employee of the light company, Gabriel de Carvalho, an employee of Gomez Galleria, commissioner of coffee, Alvaro, and a do-nothing rich lad, Geraldo. Only a club could make a family out of these people. They would meet in the afternoon in America's hall beneath the grandstand, the same grandstand built in 1911 with badly attached boards opening up cracks through which one could see the legs of the young ladies on game day. Many players stretched their necks before they went to the changing room in search of a well-turned leg. The hall had wicker chairs. The players would sit down, pulling their chairs closer to Paula Ramos, the team captain. Paula Ramos almost always had a letter from Belfort Duarte. Belfort Duarte in Resende never forgot America for even one day. It was like he was writing letters from a father to his sons. The players of America, at least, listened to the readings of the letters of Belfort Duarte with the attention of someone receiving fatherly advice. Belfort Duarte no longer yelled, could no longer throw players off the field. He had ceased being Madame, the housewife almost hysterical from so much work, running here and there, becoming a father of children already grown, with the care of an older brother. Once in a while he would come down from Resende, on a training day or a game day. On a game day, he would stay quiet for 40 minutes, awaiting halftime to pay a visit to the changing room. He would tell them what he had liked, what he hadn't. On a training day, he would come on the field, stopping the training to give his advice. The player he was addressing would nod his head repeatedly. Everyone nodded their heads. What Belfort said was sacred to them. For that reason, every afternoon, When they arrived at America, they asked if there was a letter from Belfort Duarte. When there was no new letter, Paula Ramos would reread the last letter, always kept in his pocket, preserved like a relic. The respect for Belfort, his love for America, was a line of unity joining all of them, which was what made them go around together to arrange pretexts to spend more time together, creating traditions like dinner after training sessions at Filho's Doxio, a restaurant in Bandiera Plaza. On Wednesdays, Enrique Chuckles Santos would, before the training session, go by the Filho's Doxio restaurant and instruct them to join some tables together. The one who paid for dinner was him, not with his own money, but with the club's money. The players, tired from training, needed to eat well. Not that they didn't eat well at home, but together at dinner, conversing and drinking a little beer, they ate even better. There would always be a bean soup and some horse meat with two eggs and French fries. For dessert, marmalade with cheese, oranges, pears, and apples, or the coconut sweets of Hilho's Doceau, famed in the neighborhood. The dinner would last a while, the players only leaving the table around 10 o'clock at night, well-fed and relaxed. The club looked after its players, trying to make sure that they, after a hard training session or an even harder game, soaking their jerseys, didn't let loose too much and start off on a bender. Gabriel de Carvalho, who usually did not eat at Filho's Doçal, would go dine with Joao Santos, as his home was close to the club, on Campos Sales as well. Gabriel de Carvalho would also emerge well-fed and relaxed. America preferred, however, that everyone go to Filho's Doçal. It was important to them, staying together in these moments when they left off being everything else they were, students, business employees, engineers, industrialists, in order to be simply America players. Vidi did not want to stop doing laps on the field. Ojero was kicking penalties with the tips of his toes, aiming right in the middle of the ball. The ball would leave his foot, carving a path in the earth. It would always enter the goal, shaking the net. The readings of Belfort Duarte's letters in the afternoons, the nights in the hall, the dinners after training sessions and games, brought the players of America closer together, giving a familial physiognomy to the team. A photograph of a team like this seemed like a picture in a family photo album. The whole family posing together, nobody missing, each one of them in his place. Such were the Flamengo of 1914 and 1915, the America of 1916, the Fluminense of 1917, 1918, and 1919. Marcos Vidal and Chico Neto, Leis, Osvaldo, and Fortes, Mano, Zeze, Welfare, Machado, and Bachi. These were names and faces that everyone saved. Memory never failed them. These were also the names that appeared in the papers, always the same. The faces that appeared in the team pictures, always the same. The picture of the team from one game serving for another. No one noticed any difference, unless it was by way of the background, sometimes the tower of Guanabara Palace, sometimes America's barrier with loads of people, sometimes the palm trees of Paysandú Street. The team was always arranged the same way, the defense in back, standing, the attack in front, kneeling. Fluminense, then, as champions 3 years in a row, was more than a second home to the players. The players lived there. Fluminense prepared a dormitory with beds for all of them. When construction began on the stadium, they rented a house close by, on Guanabara Street, for all of them, with a visiting room, a dining room, and bedrooms. It was a good house, perfectly suited to them, with the advantage that it was a Fluminense house. Early in the morning, the Fluminense players would wake up and go to the field to do something that the players from other clubs had never done, individual training. Fluminense had contracted a Mr. Taylor for this, to physically prepare the players. Arnaldo Gunley, president of the club, a millionaire many times over, set the example. He would wake up at the same time as the players, then be driven to the field in his all-white Cunningham with its soft springs and large seat in the back, like a cushioned sofa. Arriving at Fluminense, he would wait for his chauffeur in uniform and wearing gloves to open the car door. He would jump out and join the players and do whatever they were doing, Swedish gymnastics, sprints, hikes up the hill, each person, Arnaldo Gwynley included, carrying his own sack of sand. After individual trainings, kick-arounds and group trainings, and before games, the players would lie down on tables appropriate for massage, because Fluminense also had what no other club had, a masseuse. Peterson loosened the muscles of the players, ending their leg swellings, so common in those who played soccer and did not get massages. Only Marcos de Mendonca did not show up in the morning at Fluminense Field for individual training. He did his gymnastics at home and had a personal masseuse. The others left Fluminense only for classes and for work. Some players were not studying or working, like Fortes or Dada. His father, Agustinho Fortes, arranged a job for his son, but Dada could not get used to life in a bank. The life at Fluminense was much better, and his father, a fan of Fluminense, who admired his son more and more as a soccer player, had no other remedy. He allowed it, not getting too worried about the whole thing. In fact, he increased Dada's monthly allowance, rewarded like Machado, who received 20 mil reais from his uncle Bandiera every time he scored a goal. Like Zezé Guimarães, a fop, his belt tight and his collar soft, drawing his neck, wearing a bow tie, the ends of his shirt sticking out of the sleeves of his coat, always a bit short. His slacks narrowed as they went down, pinching at the ankle, and could only be put on before he had put on his shoes, which had pointy tips and looked like motorboats. Zezé Guimarães was not working, not doing anything, even joking about the others who worked. When Harry Welfare, after a training session and an eggnog, was preparing to leave for work, Zezé Guimarães could not resist yelling, "You going already, slave?" And Welfare was not the only one who worked. There was also Mano, younger than Zezé, who was a functionary at the Court of Accounts, Osvaldo Gomez, a teacher who had always played soccer, and Laís, an assistant broker, Chico Neto, with a pharmacy degree, a sworn clerk of notary Noemio Xavier da Silveira, making 700 mil reais, 350 mil in salary, and another 350 mil in expenses, plenty of money at that time, even more so for someone who lived at the club, and Vidal, the baron, who could live the good life of Zezé. Guimarães, with his position at the Caixa Econômica, Marcos de Mendonca had two jobs, one in the Cuero's plant, the other in the locomotive and construction company. He had enrolled in the Polytechnical School and was engaged to Ana Amelia. He was going to get married and be a father, all in those years of the triple championship. Since 1916, Marcos de Mendonca had been delaying the moment when he would leave soccer, letting the time roll by a bit longer, to win one championship, then another. Soccer had not yet given him what he wanted, the title of three-time Carioca champion, the title of South American champion, the medals that were missing from Anna Amelia's bracelet. Also, soccer was not interfering with his life. He was still Marcos de Mendonca, the purple stripe, with special privileges, specifically that of remaining at home in the morning and not having to obey Mr. Taylor. Marcos de Mendonca showed up at Fluminense on Thursdays and Sundays only, on training days and game days. He did not go to Lamas for a 100-point billiards game, much less to try the famous scrambled eggs and ham. He did not go to the 11 o'clock mass at the Matriz da Gloria, something that even welfare did, not to hear the mass or to see the young ladies, but to be with his teammates, with Vidal and Chico Nieto, Laís and Fortes, Mano and Zeze, and Machado and Bachi. The Fluminense players often mix with the Flamengo players, forming lines down the staircases of the Matriz da Gloria and forming groups at Lamas. On the day of a matchup between the clubs, a fla-flu, they would sometimes go together, arm in arm, up Laranjera Street, yelling out hip hurrahs without rhyme or reason. Windows would open and close quickly. Game time was approaching. Once in a while, one could see the teacher, Osvaldo Gomez, taken by surprise, almost dragged. But never would they see Marcos de Mendonca. Not even at the home of Coelho Neto, where the Fluminense players gathered on Sundays after a game. Not even on the nights of literary gatherings did Marcos de Mendonca remain close to the others. Almost everyone else gathered in the dining room, and Marcos de Mendonca would go to the visiting room. Donna Gabby would sit down at the piano. Sometimes she would sing, and Ana Amelia always recited verses. Marcos de Mendonca, with his back to the window, would watch Ana Amelia. Few players would stay in the visiting room. Osvaldo Gomez, Vidal the Baron, and Chico Neto, with his long poet's hair. Chico Neto did not even look like a soccer player. Marcos de Mendonca would have a conversation with Vidal or Chico Neto in the visiting room of Coelho Neto or in the office of Arnaldo Guinley. Marcos de Mendonca would sink into a leather chair, cross his legs, and feel at home at Fluminense. And he understood Fluminense. He wasn't interested in Lamas or the staircase of the Matriz da Gloria, only Coelho Neto's visiting room and Arnaldo Guinley's office. Or, on special occasion, the second-floor hall of the Sul America restaurant. Fluminense would win a game, and Arnaldo Guinley would have them prepare a good dinner at Sul America. Marcos would come and sing with the others. Everyone would sing, holding their glasses, marking the time with their nodding heads. There was no shortage of Fluminense songs, some with lyrics by Ana Amelia, others with lyrics by Luis de Mendoza. Fluminense, O Fluminense, glory be to thee, written by Ana Amelia. We are all Fluminense, and play with love. The tricolor jersey is only worn with love. By Luis de Mendonca. There were more songs by Luis de Mendonca than by Ana Amelia. We always sing our victory for everyone to hear, for in Rio de Janeiro we're champions each year, thus we players give this cheer. They would all be there, no one missing, Marcos de Mendonca singing louder, encouraging the others. Fluminense won, when to win there was no way. Some saint performed a miracle. Who's the saint of the day? Saint Benedict, Saint George, Saint John, and Saint Joe? What matters the saint? We're champions, you know. To sing like that after a victory dinner was considered proper, by Marcos de Mendoza, a good English custom. It sufficed to look at Welfare, already a bit drunk, swinging his head. It seemed as if he were in England. Everything had its time, its place, even the somersault of Vidal. Every time Fluminense scored a goal, Marcos de Mendonca was not capable of doing something like that in front of everyone, but he felt the same thing the others felt when Vidal did a somersault. More will to win. Without scandal, without ceasing to be who he was Marcos de Mendonca at all times. And despite this, he to one side, the rest of the team to the other, it did not put them out of tune. On the contrary, one could not recite the Fluminense team without beginning with Marcos de Mendonca. One recited the Fluminense team like a sonnet. Di-di-da, di-di-da, di-di-da. Perfect decasyllables, like listening to stars, by Billac. The sonnet of Fluminense, working in form and meaning. Beyond ready with Marcos, Vidal, and Chico Nieta, Laís, Osvaldo and Fortes, Mano, Zize, Welfare, Machado, and Bachi. One could not touch a syllable without ruining everything. The air would immediately perceive the difference in the dissonance of a broken foot, which is what happened when one tried to recite any other team that had not won championships, each one with its broken foot, the name of a player who should not have been on the team. On Fluminense, there was no dissonance. Marcos, Vidal, and Chico Nieta, the so-called golden trio, Marcos would go one way, Vidal another, Chico Nieta still another, to get it right. This is how they understood one another. A similar case is that of Welfare and Fortes. Welfare, quite English, taught mischief to Fortes, who was very Brazilian. When the two were together conversing, it seemed as if Fortes would never be able to understand Welfare. How could he, if Welfare did not speak Portuguese and Fortes did not speak English? But Fortes understood. He would go to the field and step on the foot of the player on the other team without anyone seeing. He would do that every time. He would do everything that was prohibited without anyone seeing. The player on the other team would find it funny. Fortes, a white society lad, an infant gate, as the columnists would say, could do whatever he wanted on the field. No one would say anything, but if somebody else were to do it, that would be something to see. For that very reason, Welfare taught Fortes more than any others. Mr. Welfare knew things that others would not even dream of learning to do. It was kind of a Yankee in King Arthur's court situation. It was like Fluminense was using a banned weapon. The other clubs had swords, while Fluminense had a machine gun. A player like that, like Welfare, could not be an amateur. A comment made by an Englishman on Corinthians when Welfare first started for Rio de Janeiro, in a corner against Corinthians, the Englishman, Snell, was preparing to jump, but he did not. The one who jumped was Welfare, after stepping on Snell's foot to score a goal. Snell went to protest, not against the foul, but against the presence of a professional on a Brazilian team. Only when they explained to him that Harry Welfare had just arrived from England, where he had played for Liverpool as an amateur, did Snell calm down. The player who had stepped on his foot had not been just any amateur. It had been a Liverpool player from the first division of the English League. That made sense to Snell, but not to the players of the other clubs. On the eve of a game against Fluminense, the players of the other clubs could not get Welfare off their minds. They knew it was necessary to keep the Englishman from scoring a goal. There was only one way. to kick welfare right in the knee. This was a recipe that Pindaru would use to the letter when he found himself in front of Gradim, a black man on the Uruguayan side. There were 10 whites and 1 black, the black Gradim, playing better soccer than many whites. Pindaro de Carvalho could not limit himself to swearing like Riva Davia Correa Meyer did, calling Grandam something ugly. For that matter, Riva Davia Correa Meyer was not even playing against Gradam. He was training, and training upon request to fill a hole. The Uruguayans telephoned from Fluminense's field over to Botafogo's. They needed 3 players in order to form 2 teams, and the 3 available were Riva Davia, Correa Meyer, Celso de Sousa, and Decio Vicares. From the 1910 Botafogo team, who were out of shape, having not played soccer in a long time, Riva Davia Correa Meyer barely had the desire to touch the ball. He took an elbow, and Gradam got the ball. His vengeance was to call Gradam a stinking black. If Gradam heard, he pretended that he hadn't, like every black man who played soccer. A black man could not get offended and fight on the field. Otherwise, he would get beaten up. People would jump out of general admission, out of the grandstand, with their canes raised, ready to thrash him. It was no use, therefore, to curse Gradam, much less so in a decisive match of the South American Championship. The only thing that would work was a kick. When Gradam got the ball, the hearts of Brazilian players grew small. It seemed as if Gradam had the devil in his body. He took 2 shots, and there were suddenly 2 Uruguayans' goals against the Brazilians. It had rained and the field was wet, and Marcos de Mendonça did not throw himself on the ground in order not to get his jersey dirty, was what they kept saying. But Gradam did not do anything more either. Pindaro de Carvalho, already a doctor, kicked Gradam much more willingly than he had ever kicked welfare. But welfare was white, and Gradam was black. He actually took pleasure in kicking a black man. The fans applauded, yelling, "There you go, Pindaro!" They let Gradam get away from him, go back to the midfield and keep his distance, which is what Gradam did. Pindaro de Carvalho was Brazilian. He was in his own land, and he could kick all he wanted. And the black Gradam disappeared from the box and did not score another goal. When he found himself with the ball at his feet, all he was thinking about was how to get rid of it as quickly as possible, because Pindaru might be close. But he had scored 2 goals and was a great player. A black man could be a great player, like Gradam. There was a throng of Gradams in Brazil and beyond. Every black man who played a bit of soccer became a Gradam.
Chapter 2, Part 4. Until then, no big club thought of recruiting black players to win a championship. Everyone was convinced that whites played much better than blacks. The proof was there. Only white teams were champions: Fluminense, Flamengo, América, and Botafogo. They had not yet seen Grandam, but they had seen Welfare, a player who practically fell from the heavens to Fluminense, knowing more soccer than the others. He could only be white. Thus, they went looking for more Welfares. América sent someone to seek out the Bertonis in São Paulo, Bertolau and Bertolinho. They were not English, but Uruguayan, but they played real soccer. Belfort Duarte arranged good jobs for them in the Saltpeter Company of Chile. The Bertones were not satisfied, however. They wanted more. They knew that America needed them, and they exploited this fact. On the eve of an important game, they would come up with a story about a good business deal awaiting them in Sao Paulo. But they couldn't go since they had to play and were thus losing money. Belfort Duarte ended up understanding what they were up to, and he booted the Bertones off of America. They would not do. Botafogo had not won a championship since 1910. Instead, watching Fluminense, Flamengo, and América win the titles. They tried to find their welfares too, importing Monte and Berengare. Monte was handsome and successful with the young ladies, and he had a hard time leaving the casinos. People would go to the casino, Así Rio, just to see him dance in Argentine tango. Monte would spend his days and nights dancing, picking up young ladies, getting himself in trouble with women, and playing soccer. He had no time for anything else. In fact, the only time he showed up at Joaquim Delamere's factory was to receive his salary. Joaquim Delamere was certain that Botafogo was operating the same way as Fluminense. Welfare had left Anglo-Brazilian for Walter and Co., but anyone going to Walter and Co. during work hours would find welfare. Just let someone go to Joaquim Delamere's factory and try to find Monte. Monte would make stops at the Colombo pastry shop, at the Asadio, and at Botafogo. Even so, Botafogo continued without a championship win, leaving that for Flamengo, América, and Fluminense. More so for Fluminense, which had welfare and everything else. The Fluminense players were sleeping at the club. On Saturdays, they left Lamas early in order not to encourage him. If welfare stayed out late, he would be apt to drink until he passed out. For this reason, and not just because of welfare, Fluminense set the time for the players to go to bed. And the players went at the scheduled time. When they woke up, they had café au lait and bread, nice and hot. They could also have a plate of ham and eggs and a cup of eggnog. The better fed the players were, the better it was for Fluminense. Only very well-fed players could stand the hard training sessions of Mr. Taylor. They ate a lot during the week, and on game day, they ate less and earlier. Before the 11 o'clock mass, some just ate scrambled eggs. After the mass, they would lie down for a massage, the changing room filled with the odor of camphor. The tea would come right before the entrance of the teams on the field. This was another one of welfare's things. Before his arrival, the players drank coffee before the game. Coffee would excite them, while tea would calm them down, and the players needed to have calm nerves. Sometimes the tea was not enough. Laís would drink the tea, bumping his chin all the way, his hand trembling. Only 5 minutes after playing would he stop trembling. All the players of Fluminense traded coffee for tea, except for Osvaldo Gomez, the teacher, who demanded his cup of coffee, so it would be 10 cups of tea, 1 cup of coffee. Osvaldo Gomez made a point of being different. Fluminense thought of everything, even the cup of coffee for Osvaldo Gomez. What other team did the same? Not any of the other big ones, let alone the small ones. There was one thing, however, that nobody had thought of, the growing importance of soccer. Even those not involved felt it, as in the case of Dr. Mario Rache. For years, as a boss, then as a partner, he sought to convince Mario de Mendonca to abandon soccer.
when he imagined a director of the Cuero's plant, of the locomotive and construction company, playing soccer, Dr. Mario Rache was scandalized. One day in 1919, however, he went to see the tiebreaker match between Brazil and Uruguay. When Friedenreich scored the winning goal, Dr. Mario Rache, crying, hugged an old Englishman whom he had never seen in his life. And the most extraordinary thing is that he kept crying and hugging that old Englishman with no shame whatsoever, jumping around like everybody else. The people on the field carried Marcos de Mendonca in triumph. There was no radio. It was the train that carried the news of the victory. At all the stations from there to Esperanza, Dr. Mario Rache yelling out the little window that Brazil was the champion. A light had gone on for him. If he played soccer like Marcos de Mendonca, he would never abandon it, be he a director of a plant, a company, what have you. But the same thing that made Dr. Mario Rache think like that was what frightened Marcos de Mendonca. Soccer was becoming too important. Ever since Abelardo de la Mer slapped Gabriel de Carvalho and Belfort Duarte started yelling at all the America players, even wishing to hit them, Marcos de Mendonca trained at home, far from the Belfort Duartes of the world. But he examined his knees every day. He knew that he was in shape because of two things, his skin knees and his silent catch, the ball dying in his hand without a sound. But he was not blind. The time of soccer for the entertainment of the player had passed. The player no longer went to the field to have fun. The one who was doing that was the fan, and only sometimes. If their team lost, the fans would demand more from the players, that they kill themselves on the field, and it would just get worse and worse. Marcos de Mendonca was just waiting for 1919, when he would be three-time Carioca champion and South America champion, and Ana Amelia's bracelet would be full of medals. It would mark the end of his career, the end of an era, the era of the reign of whites in soccer. The popularity of Friedenreich was waning, was a warning. What the fans were interested in now was the winning goal, the ball reaching the back of the net. Whether it was put there by a white, a mulatto, or a black hardly mattered. A mulatto player could be a Friedenreich, a black player could be a Grandin. Whoever might want to find a good player did not need to go far, just anywhere there was an empty lot. Brazil had many more mulattoes and blacks than Uruguay, and thus many more Friedenreichs and Grandins. Once in a while, someone would show up at a big club with the news that he had seen a Grandin. Some clubs would go to sea, while others would not, wishing to win championships with whites, no Grandins. And the fans would put the pressure on. He's a Grandin. He looks like a Grandin. He plays like a Grandin, as in the case of Montiega.
Looks like a Grandin. Plays like a Grandin. They made a black male's name an insult. That's like, say, he plays like Gus. He looks like Gus instead of Negra. Like, what? That's democratization. He said this was the end, right? The era of soccer, football as entertainment. So we are, let me see, Friday, Saturday, 3 days from the brain damage bowl. I meant Super Bowl. That's what I meant to say. And we're taking our spot back. We're on every day, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and Monday, every day. But we are taking our spot back. Dr. Francis Cress Welsing said there should be a book club, reading more important than watching television. She was here 31 times. multiple times. She was here on Super Bowl Sunday, live with the game, resuming our tradition. We will be here Sunday with a white guest broadcasting live. But you talk about the end of football as entertainment for the player. Man, they said just for this one game this weekend, 16 billion dollars in wagers. One game. Way too serious. Hope nobody dies on the field. Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy, 14-year anniversary. Make sure I get the math correct. Book Club was 2012, so that's 11 years of the book club. Man, I have to do our list of all of the books that we have read. Again, I think if you just read half of these books, you would learn a lot. Alrighty, so we stopped for me. We're in the middle of chapter 2. We are on page 91. Great. We're picking up on James Barcelos, Director of Soccer for America. That's what we'll pick up at for audio segment 2. The number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The email, untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. Let's see, I'll nab one of our emails first, and then we'll get to folks who got the wrong one. Chinkies. Thought I was being so slick. Let's try that again. All right. We'll do one. Reading 5, The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. I looked up the population of Brazil during the 1920s and came up with a figure of 30 million. Not sure what percentage were considered black during this time period, but I suppose it had to be in the millions easily. Especially, I think there have been more black people in that part of the world in terms of this hemisphere. I think there have been more black people there than anywhere else for well over a century. That's the whole point, or one of the major points, of the Gold Coast, the Sublette's book, that most of the people stolen from the continent of Africa were taken to the Caribbean, South America, places like Brazil. They did not end up here, meaning the U.S. He continues, I am thinking this book is just describing racial showcasing of non-white victims for white entertainment, and calling it democratization seems familiar. For that is what I said last week with different wording, right? We all have different brain computers and all the rest of it, but absolutely, there is so much white people, like I said, I'm not sure, but I think this author who's writing this note, I think he said that he thinks Mr. Filo would be white. I said, I think that's probably the case as well. Other people can check. We'll see. But white people all over the world, confusion. They lie about what racism, white supremacy is. And we even said that. I think we talked about that before. Who do we think this book was written for in 1947, the year of Jackie Robinson, among other things? Who do we think this book was written for in Portuguese? Especially given what we heard this week at the very beginning, who do we think was sitting around reading The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer in 1947? For whose entertainment shall we sing our... And even think, Now, even think about that. I had to think about that. I hadn't really processed that. We had to think about that going through. So what do we even make of that? He wrote this book for white people in Brazil to what? Enjoy? Oh, look at that, about Gratom and the leather balls and the black street urchins. And to even congratulate themselves about how they are no longer racist. Look how much progress. They do. They love that, right? Look how much progress we've made. We didn't even let them write or play soccer. And look at us now. Brazil is, we don't know, there's no color here. We don't have any problems with racism here. This is Brazil. Number one. Page 82, photograph of teen like a family photo album. I looked at a picture of this team. I think it is from the time period and appeared to be maybe half white and what they may have called mulatto players. I doubt that the white and non-white players functioned as a family regardless of the photograph. Absolutely. Number two, page 83, Fluminense players wake up, something other players had never done, individual training, massage, masseuse, ending their leg swelling. Were the masseuses male or female? Now, certainly, we've talked a lot about this author as well, about the homoeroticism in the text. Now, you know, hey, it's 2023, almost 2025. In the world of sports medicine and the Super Bowl, I am sure both the Kansas City Chiefs and Philadelphia Eagles will have male sports therapists and maybe even masseurs who are massaging players and touching them in intimate areas and all the rest of it. So I think there's a long tradition of that, right? Can't be professional. All of that said, man, homoeroticism, slave culture. Number three. Page 84. ZZ Gumarez, man, these names, a fop, Harry Welfare, ZZ Gumarez, you going already, huh? Slave, a fop is a synonym for dandy, a man excessively concerned about his clothes and appearance. I didn't even know that, man, still learning, a fop, A-F-O-P. What? I have to look that up. That's amazing. A synonym for dandy. He used that term in the book before. That's one of those words that kind of caught my attention. I already knew what it was, but we had already said the homoeroticism seems like a big theme in this book in a variety of ways. And then specifically, I think I said last week about the emasculation of the non-white characters. I'd say especially the mulatto characters. It talks so much about how they, their attention to their hair and dress, and they have to present themselves as immaculate, I think the word we heard this week. But we heard a non-white player described as a dandy for that sort of behavior. I have to be presentable for white people to get a fop, to get it again. Wow, the emasculation of non, the man is white. The rest of you all are just urchins and dandies and fancy pantses and afops and something other than the man in the high castle. Let's see. Oh, I didn't even finish. Afop stunned me so. Afop is a synonym for a dandy, a man excessively concerned about his clothes and appearance. I think since both of these players are white, this could be thought of as a racist joke, perhaps, given the close proximity of the end of slavery in Brazil during this time period. Now, I'm glad I finished the note because I think he's correct. In this instance, he is not calling non-white people dandies. However, I said that also last week, the soccer, this being a child's game and them getting more serious about this, we got to have all this practice. They hadn't been doing that before. Now we got to have practice and grueling practices and massage, you know, therapists and all the rest of it, that it was taking up more time. So that, as he said this week, students are now playing. This is not, you know, grown people and all the rest who are doctors and lawyers, white people who have serious jobs. This is students, children, they have a lot of free time where they can play soccer all day long, or it's easy. They have a lot easier time to schedule things. Where you see white people bragging about having free time, I can devote hours to this child's game because I'm a white man. I have so much power that I have time. And then I can insult other white people who have to go to work. And how did he insult him? Called him a slave. Exactly what he said. I've been pointing that out. Slavery only ended in Brazil in 1888. This time period is 20th century. So who are the slaves? Same thing you'd be saying here. Same insult. It'd be the same thing. You don't have to explain that. Once you get it from Portuguese to English, I got it. Nothing lost in translation. I got it. That's how you insult a white man today, 2023. Whoosh. Going to work, huh, Kunta? Whoosh. Punch that clock. I got it. Yeah, yeah. Slave culture. And the racist. That's a racist joke, too. Even though it's targeting another white man. That is total racist joke, and you can't be ignorant about racism and make that joke or even understand. I hear you. Oh, insult trying to niggerize me. Wait till I get back from work. Number four. Welfare and Fortes, English, Brazilian. Welfare did not speak Portuguese. Fortes did not speak English, but Fortes understood. Fortes could go on the field and step on the foot of another player. He could not do that. Was prohibited. They spoke their common language, the language of racism, white supremacy. Fortes, a white society lad, an infant gate, as colonists would say. Welfare taught Fortes, a Yankee in King Arthur's court. Infant gate is translated as spoiled child. I got the infant part, but the gate I wouldn't have. Wowzers. The book Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court was a novel published in 1889 by the great Mark Twain. We did a book study on Huckleberry Finn on the cows. Like, even our record of fiction over the years, like, pshaw. The plot involves a white male living in the time of when the book was published, who is magically transported to the time of the reign of King Arthur's after a blow to the head. That would be our cow's word, anachronism, where you have something that is out of place temporally, like talking about, black nationalism in 2025. Or high-speed Wi-Fi in 1775. All of that would count. This novel that we're talking about, anachronism. Anachronistic thinking. Number six. Uruguayan black Gratum playing better soccer than many whites. Call Gratum a stinking black. A black man could not get offended and fight on the field. Otherwise, he would get beaten up. Gratum had the devil in his body. WTH, man, like, for real. Pindaro kicked Gratum, took pleasure in kicking a black man. They do that now, don't they? Got foot on his. Anyway. End of an era, the era of the reign of whites in soccer. Winning goal, a white, a mulatto, a black, hardly mattered. The black misentry in this section is astounding. And to end up saying black hardly mattered. I feel like he says that so many times in the book. Is that just me? Like, it's all in that. The democratization in Brazil. Oh, nobody cared. Being black didn't even be in. Nobody even cared about color in it. And then you got to come back with all that. Boy, he used to kick the stuffing out of that Negro. Didn't he kick old stinking no-count Negro and just kick him to death? And that's right. Get out of here, you Gratum. He plays like a Negro. He plays just like a Negro. Kick that. I thought... Is this democracy? What kind of democratization is this? If this is democratization, just call me a slave, man. Don't you play around with all these goofy terms all over the world, man. Let's see. Oh, we didn't get that far. Bango. We can stop right there. All right. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. There's so many things I could say about that section. I highlighted that section as well, obviously, for many reasons. I will only say that last sentence, I think, is very much in line with the so-called democratization. When he says the era of the reign of whites, the end of an era, the era of the reign of whites in soccer. I submit, just using counter-racist logic, as long as the system of white supremacy risks, you can call it the Rooney Rule or anything else, the era of white domination of football, tackle, or soccer continues. You put what they call it, the ellipsis, dot, dot, dot. If white people still decide who's going to coach the team, white people still decide who's going to be on the team, white people are the ones. I don't see tons of niggers in the stands when the Brazilian soccer team, with all their dominance, and they go out and win this and win that and win this and win that. I don't see tons of dark people all out in the stands. Same way I didn't see tons of dark people out in the hooliganism back last month. Maybe I missed them. I don't watch every soccer game. Maybe I just don't see them. But that, to me, I don't think white people, I don't think black people in Brazil, I don't think they got all the sky boxes and everything and own the sports stadium and all that. They got one of the stadiums is named after the author of this flipping book. Anywho, and that's all over the world. When they get to the Super Bowl this weekend, you can forget, oh yeah, they got two Negro quarterbacks. Mm-hmm, that's true. The Eagles are owned by a white man. The Chiefs are owned by a white man, and they will get the trophy from a white person this weekend. That is the continued reign of the white man. Even the World Cup from this past year in Qatar. White people rule still. And then fuss at and blame the black people when they mess up or don't get a goal or allow a goal. And that continues 21st century. What domination look like, they say. I could be wrong. Let's see. Folks who dialed in with a hand up. If you have commentary on the first portion of the black man in Brazilian soccer. Proceed, Lauren. 2262.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for letting me speak. I am on page 77, right at the beginning. It seems like every time it starts, it's something interesting right there at the beginning. And it says, and perhaps there in that excuse for a loss was the explanation of everything, of the superiority of the players from the big clubs. Players who had family. Family meant a good home and good food. The advantage of having a home, of eating well, was one thing, but there was also the advantage of knowing how to read and write. I thought that was interesting. They did talk about that last week, how much better it was to be a white person, a reference getting tuberculosis. I think it's pretty beneficial to be a white person in almost all areas of people activity. Then later, it was talking about Alberto Borgert and the way he had to change his name. Well, he didn't change his name because he couldn't read and write like the non-white people. His father apparently felt ashamed or embarrassed that he was playing soccer even though he was out of medical school. So he talked to the newspaper and got them to stop printing his name. So instead of putting Borgert, I hope I'm saying that correctly, they would put Borges or Borgia. Now, I thought to myself, I asked myself, If this was a non-white player, would he have been able to get the newspaper to do that? I don't think so. And also, I don't think a non-white player would have felt shame for playing soccer. I mean, these people in this area of the world, most of them didn't have enough food. A lot of these people obviously didn't have a place to stay. That was evidenced by the ones that were sleeping on the floor in the club last week. So that's what I thought. And then it said, it's still talking about Alberto Borgia. When he knew he wanted to become a doctor, he would take the pulse of the players before and after the training sessions and games just to check something. The players allowed him to do it as a joke, but they didn't believe in it, despite the fact that they too were studying to be doctors. Alberto Borgia ended up stopping in order not to seem pedantic. I thought that was weird because these people are doctors. What do you mean they didn't believe in it? A pulse is pretty important. It's a, you know, indication of how things are going, you know, with your heart, how fast. I mean, that's pretty important. It's like, but I don't know, back then, I'm not even sure if they really understood how important washing your hands was. Not sure when that came about. I should look that up. I guess I should look and see when Lister, that guy created Listerine, because that would have been right around the same time that the origin of antiseptics. Pedantic. I actually looked that up, and it said narrowly, stodgily, and often ostentatiously learned. And the example said, far worse, he was pedantic, pernickety. I've never heard that word. I usually hear persnickety. Letting nothing inaccurate or of uncertain meaning go by, not an aphrodisiac quality. And it said, when I looked it up, that it was supposed to be insulting, but I don't understand what's incorrect about striving for accuracy. That doesn't really make sense to me. I mean, don't be discourteous, but if something is incorrect, you should probably say that. I did note, and I've been seeing it every week or noticing it every week, just the constant contradictions of this author. I looked up another word. It was physiognomy, a person's facial features or expression, especially when regarded as indicative of character or ethnic origin. The general form or appearance of something. Example, he and his son have the same distinctive physiognomy. So I don't know. I didn't know that one. So I thought maybe someone else might not be familiar with that term as well. Page 84. Give me a second there, guys. Before I get to 84, I did notice that they weren't calling Draper Duarte madam anymore. And then it said the housewife, almost hysterical from so much work, running here and there, becoming a father of children already grown with the care of an older brother. I don't know. They had to bring that back up again. It seems the food is a big part of this. I don't know if, am I just focusing every time they talk about food because of the book we read previously. But it said there would always be a bean soup and some horse meat with two eggs and french fries. For dessert, marmalade with cheese, oranges, pears, and apples, or the coconut sweets of Filo Sto Q. I don't know if I'm saying that correctly, famed in the neighborhood. The dinner would last a while, and players only leaving the table around 10 o'clock at night, well-fed and relaxed. I think, again, a lot of these people do not have enough food to eat. And also, I think it's really surprising the amount of detail that the author was able to put into the book about things that seem unimportant to me. But I guess I'm not the judge of that. But, you know, the mustache is the first week. The meals, that's cool. I like the detail on that, but some of the stuff, it just seems a lot. Let's see. Okay. When they call ZZ, Guama, oh man, these names. The narrator is doing an excellent job because I don't know how to say a lot of these names. I'm going to just say ZZ. When they call this person a fop, I am familiar with that term. And it was kind of funny. I know name calling shouldn't be funny, but they were so specific about his clothing. I wasn't sure if he was white or non-white, but the author seems to reserve the specificity of dress for non-white people. And it said his belt tight and his collar soft, drowning his neck, wearing a bow tie, the ends of his shirt sticking out of the sleeves of his coat, always a bit short. His slacks narrowed as they went down, pinching at the ankle, and could only be put on before he had put on his shoes, which had pointy tips and looked like motorboats. That's very specific. And also it made me wonder, was there a lot of people back then putting on their shoes before they put on their pants? That seems like a weird order to go in. You would get your pants dirty on the inside, but anyway, I noticed the slave thing. I highlighted that, but that was already talked about. The phrase, a good English custom, things being called good in English, I think that happened twice in the last section. And I think English just means white. Let me see. Okay, and they were talking about Fortes. I think the email addressed this, but it said Fortes understood he would go on the field and step on the foot of the player on the other team without anyone seeing. He would do everything that was prohibited without anyone seeing. The player on the other team would find it funny. Fortes, a white society lad, an infant, Gate, as the columnists would say, could do whatever he wanted on the field. No one would say anything, like three times. But if somebody else were to do it, that would be something to see. That's pretty much still what it means to be white. You know, there's supposed to be rules in effect, but these rules seem to be just for non-white people, and white people can do whatever it is they want. I think, it's kind of what it means. The whole part about Gradom, 10 whites and one black, and he played better soccer than many whites, again, very contradictory. You know, they'll talk about race doesn't matter, and then, you know, somebody's calling Gradom a stinking black, and it said a black man could not get offended and fight on the field. Otherwise, he would get beaten up. People would jump out of general admission, out of the grandstand with their canes raised, ready to thrash him. Wow. It made me think, okay, number one, I don't think it mattered if he got offended. That's not the important part. The important part is you are not supposed to hit a white person. And if you do, you're going to be punished by the other white people and possibly non-white people because they said general admission. This author does a lot of talking about, I don't know, somehow he talks about race without actually using that term or specifying whether a person is white or non-white. I don't know. Let me see. When he got kicked, that part was, it says Pindaro de Carvalho, already a doctor, kicked Gradom much more willingly than he had ever kicked Welfare. But Welfare was white and Gradom was black. He actually took pleasure in kicking a black man. The fans applauded, yelling, "There you go, Pindaro." They let Gradom get away from him, go back to the midfield and keep his distance, which is what Gradom did. This person is a doctor and going around kicking black people. It really makes me wonder how he treats non-white people when he's at his clinic or his practice, whatever. My aunt just asked me not too long ago if I thought white people, like white doctors, were practicing racism, and she was serious. But if a person practices racism, they're not going to stop practicing racism when they get to work. I don't think, you know, that's how these things go. Let me see. I feel like I've been talking for a while, so I guess we can, I'll just go to the last part. Everyone was convinced that whites played much better than blacks. The proof was the only white teams, correction, the proof was that only white teams were champions. They had not yet seen Bradham, but they had seen Welfare, a player practically fell from the heavens to Fluminense, knowing more soccer than the others. He could only be white. Fell from the heavens. And also, I thought that name Welfare was, I've never heard of a person named Welfare, so that kind of stood out to me. That's all I have for now. Thank you.
Much obliged, Lauren. I guess two quickies. One, I think she said it was her mother asked her, do you think these white doctors practice racism against black patients? Dr. Susan Moore, if my memory is correct, she had COVID. She was a doctor. She made a whole video saying that the white doctors were practicing racism against her, and she died. And then they said that she was hostile after she had died. I guess that's extra. But then there's a book, Black and Blue, The Origins and Consequences of Medical Racism. That is exactly what that book is about, by John Hoberman, white man. She can either read the book or she can listen to that time he was a guest on the program, and we talked about this book. But that's the whole thesis of the book. And then, same subject, when she talked about, importantly, dang, pedantic. Why would they feel he was being pedantic by applying what he's learned as a medical doctor? There are lots of other doctors on the soccer team. Why would they have disdain for this? And she said, oh, wait a minute. What was the understanding of Western medicine, as they call it? What was the understanding of medicine at that time? Did they even understand the importance of washing their hands? I would strongly submit, no. Now, sterilization came a long way from the Civil War, so-called slavery. But that was still a problem well into the 20th century. We read Rebecca Skloot, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks. That was a problem. Came up in that book, them not washing their hands and just being unsanitary with the specimens that they were trying to study in a scientific manner, no less. So I'm very certain that was probably still a big issue, and probably a part of that attitude of disdain that they had for what he was doing. Anywho, let's see. Other folks who dialed in with a hand up, proceed.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you for taking my call, and greetings to all the participants and the listeners to the book club. I wanted to first comment on page 82, where they had the Fluminense also had what no other club had, a masseuse. That right there, to me, that talks about the, or brings back up the whole idea of the homoeroticism that's rampant throughout the book. And it was just that would be my opinion about that one. The next part was in page 88. Otherwise, he would get beaten up, would jump out of the general admission, out of the grandstands when he was thinking that they would attack him for defending himself or anything like that. I was thinking that, hey, we're not going to be at our best dealing with this system. We're not going to be at our best doing anything, trying to be innovative in any type of field or anything like that if we're constantly terrorized. So, I mean, that to me speaks volumes about the total global system of racism. And also talks about how white people will function as a gang when it comes dealing with us. And I was also thinking that what is the purpose of these white people ultimately coming to watch this game besides just drinking and other things that they do? I would think that they're probably just waiting for an opportunity to act in this way. Other soccer games that I've seen on YouTube, a lot of those, if the fans don't like what's going on, they jump in the field and they get into fights, or even law enforcement, from what I've seen. The part page 91, where they talked about the black male from Uruguay, Gratum, I think, and they are comparing him to, I guess, well, they used his name as a, I guess, reference for any black male who, I guess, any black male. I was thinking that that could be, that using his name like that is like they're taking away his agency, not to mention degendering him too, but they're not even really applying that gender. It's like just is grade him this and grade him that. I was also thinking that that could be, that's how, I guess, here in American sports, when it comes to like people say this is a like a certain archetype, like this is a Jordan type, or it's got players like Jordan, it's got players like Kobe, stuff like that. I said, well, that's what I was thinking also. And also, like, I guess it was also with the term gratum, use it to rate a certain player's prowess or black male's prowess. So I was also thinking that that term could be comparative to the Mandingo term as well. But that's so far if I have my notes, and thank you for taking my call.
Much obliged, our caller at 2262. Degendered, dehumanized, like all of the not a person at all. Like all of you. Yeah, you're just another little gratum. Let's see. Get to some of my, I wrote this before we even got through this week. This book has no females, like, at all. All of the people who get a name that we kind of follow and what have you are all males. Now, I get it's about soccer, but I mean, dang, there's no mother of a player. There's no, you know, these female soccer fans or wife, or I mean, it is male dominant through the entirety of what we've read thus far. Now, we've read about a third of the book or so. That just stands out to me. I guess we can compare to some of the other sports books that we've read. I remember Bill Russell, he talked about a lot of females, his mother first and foremost. That's not here. We haven't heard any, you know, glowing, oh, mom, and she was here. Oh, man, you know, they teased me and kicked me in the knee and the groin and probably everything else. And, you know, Gratum went home and his mother, name, she comfort, like, there's none of that here. It's just dudes and dudes and dudes and shindigs and dudes. And on top of everything else, even the masseuses are due. Like, man. Anyway, I too, like Lauren, I was highlighting from the very first sentence. I guess that's like, pay attention, but this, like right from the opening bell. The excuse from a loss that they start chapter 2.3 with, the end of the previous section was that they had this team of ragamuffins on the backup squad, the JV, I guess you would say, of black and non-white players, and this white club lost to them. And so it was like, well, that doesn't really count because they're no counts, and, you know, they don't even have families, these cast-offs and all the rest of it. That was the way that we ended last week. So they say the excuse was the explanation for everything of the superiority of the players from the big clubs, players who had family. Family meant a good home and good food. It talked last week about the players that were poor, non-white players. They had to stay at the club on the floor, all the rest of it. The other players would only do this after a bender. And I started today to lack of food. That's been in the book throughout. That continues right now. 2023 Brazil, black people, no food. Delectable Negro. That's two books in a row that focused on that. And black people, I'm going to play this ball game as well as I can or die so that I can get a can of soup. Now, how is that the case from North America to South America for the last 100 years? Let's see. The advantage of having a home, eating well, was one thing, but there was also the advantage of knowing how to read and write. You think, which many people thought was more important, a little. Working of Carioca took a lifetime to scribble their names. Some broke into a cold sweat, trembling, thinking they would never be able to sign their names in front of white people. Now, I changed that part, but I mean, wow. That is, I mean, you could easily, especially for this time period, you could have been talking about Mississippi, Georgia, isn't that places where they had grandfather clause and the poll tax? That would be part of it. Literacy test. I mean, you had tons of white people who were illiterate at that time, too, and they talked about that in the book already. They said they would bring in white tutors to get those white players caught up so they could sign their name and probably teach them how to read in general. Staggering the similarities. Let me continue. They said, and they had to sign their names more than 1,000 times from Friday through Sunday. Every small club would arrange a teacher, but only to teach soccer players to sign their names. That to me is super niggerish. We're not going to teach you to read so you could be a more functional citizen. More learned, go to the library, do a little reading, write your own book about the black man in Brazil. Let's not get carried away with it. It's just a name. That's all. Like, what? That is plantation culture right there. No reading for the Negro. Let's see. They said, and on Andre. And Anacleto, a mulatto player who knew his letters, would take charge of the player, locking himself up with him. All the player had to do was sign his name to accustom his hand to writing it by tracing the letters. All of this seems draconian. It seems like, why would I be up here sweating? And, oh my God, I can't get this L straight. Ooh, they gonna, like, what? That's why I say it sounds like exactly like the poll tax and all the rest of it. Like, oh, yeah, Negro, you're trying to vote? Let's see. We got our test here. Let's see if you can read this paragraph for us. Like, come on, man. Like, you all burned down our school. That's what was in Bill Russell's book. We tried to build a school. You all came and didn't want to sell us the wood and then burn the school down. Come on. Let's see. The club would lose points. That's why I said all this seems punitive, racist. And the league would call him in for an exam, giving him a primer to read, literacy test. There were some players who could not sign that score sheet no matter what. It seemed they had learned, but in a moment they forgot, and the club would need to arrange for another to go on the field. Like, what? All of this for a child's game? Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord. I've been reading about Jim Jones this week. For them to get on page 78, the importance was exaggerated by the cult of the student. There was naturally a reason for this cult. Flamengo won 2 consecutive championships. Brazil is right next to Guyana. Jonestown. The cult of sports. Absolutely. Our last caller, that's all of soccer. We are just waiting for the opportunity after we drank 10 or 20 beers. We are just waiting for the opportunity to act a fool. And racism, oh my gosh, I hope there is a Negro. I hope that Negro does miss a penalty kick or allow a goal. Oh my, I got my banana in my pocket right here, ready to roll. They got years of documentary, like HD documentaries, talking about all of this, even at the World Cup in Qatar that we just had. Let's see. I, too, thought that was important about them resisting him being pedantic and checking their heartbeat. Not a single player on Flamingo went a day without meeting with the others. On some mornings, they would take a boat trip, then take a dip in the sea. Is that skinny dipping? The swim was one more pretext to do a run from the garage to the Hotel Central, then back. Nobody took any notice, as Flamingo players looked like bathers, dressed similarly to everyone else, with tight shorts that reached to their knees. All of it again, we're back to the fashion and how tight the clothing and all of it, the homoeroticism again, like just all of these white dudes hanging out together and we go bathe together and run to, like, come on. A little game of billiards, Welsing moment. She has a whole section in the icing papers about that. They spent their evenings at the boarding house. Once again, all these dudes hanging out, very frat house kind of vibe throughout this book. Food. Let's see. We do have females are mentioned. They'll be mentioned generally at the games. We had to sneeze. But they'll be mentioned as spectators at the games, but it's more like they're decorations almost, because it will mention them, like with the ribbons and all the trouble that they go through to order the ribbons from old England and all of that, and they have straw hats and they're sitting on the grandstand and they can look through their legs, but I mean, they're just kind of side ornaments. The real bonding is me being with my bros, going out for a bender, are we going to the shindig where we dance with other dudes? Let's see. Horse meat with eggs. They had lots of mention of eating eggs. I've never had horse meat, I do not think, but it does not sound like anything I want. Alrighty. We had physiognomy. I believe is the pronunciation, physiognomy. That I looked that word up too. I also was ignorant, still learning. I looked it up. I'm going to read the definition again just because I didn't know what it meant. I think Lauren said she didn't know what it meant. Maybe there'll be other folks. So the definition, a person's facial features or expression, especially when regarded as indicative of character or ethnic origin. So the context for this is Gabriel de Carvalho, who usually did not eat filos de cua, would go down with Joa Santos at his home, as his home was close to the club on Campo Sales as well. Gabriel de Carvalho would also emerge well-fed and relaxed. America preferred, however, that everyone go to Filos do Seo. It was important to them staying together in these moments when they left off being everything else they were: students, business employees, engineers, industrialists, in order to simply be America players. BT did not want to stop doing laps on the field. Ojeda was kicking penalties with the tips of his toes, aiming right in the middle of the ball. The ball would leave his foot, carving a path in the earth. It would always enter the goal, shaking the net. The readings of Belfort Duarte's letters in the afternoons, the nights in the hall, the dinners after training sessions and games brought the players of America closer together, giving a familiar physiognomy to the team. Now, it said character, right? That was a part of the definition, but it's a person's facial features or expression, especially when regarded as indicative of character or ethnic origin. Now, I guess if they sit around and hear these letters of Duarte and they're, you know, all listening, and this is such a cherished moment, and we all have that look of sincerity, and we're on every letter, every word, ooh, we have that sense of character. This is important to our common bond. But it also included ethnic origin. So, and is this one of the big teams where they exclude all of the non-white people? Certainly all of the Gradums? and our common white faces and our common white bond go out in superiority to the white man as ball players? Okie doke. Let's see. Already talked about the masseuse. Talked about the insult, zeze, gumares. You go into work bragging about not having to work. He's a fop, right? Doesn't have to work. Kind of a dandy. Let's see. Marcos de Mandanca would sink into a leather chair, cross his legs, and feel at home at Fluminense. I just thought that was important because we've had such graphic and sexual descriptions of black leather balls. Remember Harry with the ox hairs and castrating the ball? How China Black would love slicing up the black leather balls last week. That Marcos de Mandanca, he feels comfortable in the black or in the leather chair again. Welsing moment. And leather seems to figure so prominently in this book. But I mean, that's really any era, right? Even now, 2023, leather, that never goes out of style, right? Even in the midst of all this veganness and let's end animal cruelty, I still want my leather jacket. Let's see. All this drinking again, like all of that just 2023, 25, whatever era, World Cup, you can drink all through the game. That's what it's supposed to be. Wake up and first thing in the morning and get a beer and cheer on the ball game. Let's see. The buddy, talk about that for Sunday. Man, we wake up. That's we're going to start drinking tomorrow in celebration of the big brain damage fest. Let's see. They say the white society lad, the spoiled child, the infant gate, could do whatever he wanted on the field. I think that's any white person, right? We've already, you go out and kick any nigger that you want to and do it. I'm a white man. The rules are for these niggers and mulattoes and gratums and all that. I'm white. I do, you know, do what I want out here on the field. Gratum being called a stinking black is important because that is, oh my goodness, there are so many reams of documentation on that in terms of that being a way that white people worldwide have practiced racism and saying black people should be mistreated because they stink. We stink. Oh my God, like it's reams of James Baldwin has written about this and all that, and particularly in the context of they'll stuff you on a slave ship for 8 months with not even water to drink, much less take a shower, and say, oh my gosh, you stink so bad. Like, Yes. Or stick you in Flint, Michigan, where the water is contaminated, so you have a choice. I can take a shower, get a little lead contamination, or I cannot shower, and then they'll put a clothespin on their nose and say that I stink and say that's why I can't have the job. Choices. Let's see. Like every black man who played soccer, he couldn't get offended on the field and blah. Didn't we hear that? Wasn't that Bill Russell? Wasn't that Jackie Robinson? The year this book was published, Jesus Christ. The same thing they had to tell Branch Rigger. You can't get upset. I'm going to smack you upside the head and say things to get you upset and all the rest. Matter of fact, I have heard this like 21st century. Marcus Smart, who played in the NBA Finals last year. Boston Celtics, like Bill Russell, won Defensive Player of the Year. He said he had a white fan who he accused of calling him a nigger when he played basketball NCAA, Oklahoma State. It was written at that time. This was just a few years ago. Not even a decade has passed where they say, hey, these players are told right now, yeah, you're going to be called a nigger and all that, and they'll try to do things upset. Don't get upset. Don't respond. Keep your cool. Progress. It seemed as if Gratum had the devil in his body. Was he raping people? Killing folks? Slitting their throats? he was scoring goals. That's the meta. That's what somebody who talks about metaphors. I don't say that I don't like metaphors. I say that they are not precise like this. What? what does that even, he got the devil in his, oh, you horny devil. Oh, my Lord, he's raping the women with the ribbons in the snow. Oh, get that great, got to castrate him. Where is the China black with a knife? Cut his black balls off right now. He's got the devil. We can't just say he's a great player. Does anybody hear that? When they talk about Beckham, right, that he used to play soccer, did they ever say that? But boy, he has got the devil in his mouth. Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's the way old Tom Brady, the other football, that's what they say about old Tom Brady when he would win the brain damage. Oh, my God. Tom Brady has got the devil in him today, boy. He is slinging that ball. I have never heard a white athlete describe devilish, got the devil in him as a compliment. We got Satan on the field. And then he came back. He called the white player welfare. He said he fell from heaven. Let's see. The crowd cheering on all of this, that is so like Roman gladiator. I mean, that's any era of white supremacy racism. That's the Floyd Mayweather fight. We want to go and cheer and hope that, you know, he dies in the ring. We want to go and cheer, hope Muhammad Ali, hope he dies on the field. Damar Hamlin, hope he dies on the, ooh, that almost happened right now. Let's see. I thought that was important too. Lauren pointed that out. She said, "Dave, you got a doctor. This is not just some hooligan with no teeth and never went to, this is a doctor. You're running around on the field, kicking, like, are you serious? Hippocratic oath, what happened to that? He didn't even wash his hands. They got a lot of eggnog here too. Like, man, I don't know what type of refrigeration they had at this part of the 20th century, but like, they don't even do eggnog year round now. Because it's difficult, it's got all that egg in it, could go bad. You really got to be careful to make sure you keep that egg, you know, correct temperature. Man, that is, talk about living dangerously. Like drinking eggnog in South America, early 20th century. Like, woo, stick with the water, man. And they said the crowd, this is serious now. If their team lost, the fans would demand more for the players, that they kill themselves on the field. And it just got worse and worse. $16 billion wagered on one game this Sunday. And I already said the reign of whites in soccer, all ball games, all areas of people activity continues. 2023 forward. Let's see. That's all I had to get. We'll go ahead and get to the second audio segment. That way we'll have ample time for folks to share or email. This is Mario Filho's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. We are picking up in Chapter 2, Katherine Massey Book Club. This is our second audio installment.
Jaime Barcelos, director of soccer for America, was a frequenter of empty lots. When America wasn't playing, Jaime Barcelo would go to Suave, to the lots, to the docks, almost always in the company of Fidel Sino Leto, one of the proprietors of Leto House. If the player was a good fit, he would be employed at Leto House. And he would not need to work much, as he played well. What Fidel Sino Leitao most wanted was for him to play well, for America to win. The field of Maurai, a club of sailors, was by the docks. Mantega played there, and he seemed to play like a Friedenreich, a Grandem. Actually, more Grandem than Friedenreich, though he was a mulatto. He would do. America could not find anyone better. Jaime Barcelos and Fidel Sino Leto started to follow Maura, the Navy side, taking advantage of every occasion to talk with Mantega, tempting him with America with a job of Leto House. Everything was in secret. Nobody at Campos Sales knew anything about it. When they found out, many people were not going to like the idea of a black man on America. But the Uruguayan side had a black man, and America was not better than the Uruguayan side. One catch was that the Metropolitan League did not allow ensigns or privates to play on any club. Montiega was a sailor, an ensign, and so in order to play for America, he would have to resign to request a discharge. But if Montiega wanted it, Fidelcino Leitao would find a way. Leitao House had big business with the Brazilian Navy. If Leitao House was not enough to entice him, Mayrink Vega would give in some effort, and Lafayette Gomez Ribiera was there with the best of wills to help America when America needed it. Montiega gradually accepted, saying that if he got discharged and Dr. Leitao arranged a job for him, he would play for America. Jaime Barcelos was hurrying Fidelcino Leitao, especially after Navy beat Andaray by a lot, with Montiega the greatest figure on the field. Several clubs had their eyes on him, though they were the small clubs who could not compete with America. The other big clubs still had an addiction to white players. With Montiega on the team, Jaime Barcelos believed that America would be champion. Fidelcino Leitao did his magic, and one day the sailor Antonio Muniz received a discharge. He was no longer a sailor. He could play for America. It was time for the championship to begin. Montiega showed up at Campo Sales to train, entered the changing room, and Ivo Borges left immediately. With a Montiega, he would not play. The other Borgeses and the Curtis left after him, followed by Paulo Viana, who was brown and had wavy hair that would make the young woman envious. With Montiega on the team, maybe they would look more at his hair. For that reason, Paulo Viana left all the more quickly. He did not want any trouble. And then there was Miranda, a player from Modesto de Quintino, and also a mulatto. The existence of Miranda was one more reason. As the Borgeses and the Curtis had said, one mulatto was enough. If America continued in this way, where would it stop? The Borgeses and the Curtis only wanted America to understand this. And if not America, then Montiega himself. Like Americano. Americano had gone from Andaray to Botafogo and ended up understanding. And he was someone with lighter skin who, with his hair straightened, could almost pass for mestizo. And no one stopped greeting him at General Severiano. On the contrary, Paulo Cunha, known as the mother of Osni, had adopted Americano as well. Traveling around with him in his red Fiat, the same Fiat that had brought Americano from Plaza Sete to General Severiano. The tough guys of Andaray had been ready for anything, awaiting the tough guys of Botafogo, who were coming to look for Americano. First, the red Fiat appeared, and Paulo Cuno jumped out, but he was not alone. He had brought the police with him. It was useless to pull out knives and revolvers to wish to fight. Americano went to Botafogo in the red Fiat of Paulo Cunha. Even so, Americano failed at General Severiano. He had to feel disoriented as his place was with Andaray in Plaza Sete, to which he returned repentant. This is what Montiega needed to do as soon as possible. Return to Morao, to the field by the docks. The America jersey was for Borgeses, for the Curtis, not for Montiega. But it was of no use. This was going to be the Borgeses, the Curtis, and Paolo Viana did not greet Montiega, but the others did. As a result, the Borgeses, the Curtis, and Paolo Viana left America, but the others stayed. There was a moment when it seemed as if no one would stay. The most alarming rumors floated around Campos Sales. There was a petition put out among the 300 members, either the Borgeses and the Curtis or Montiega. Things were invented to scare João Santos, the president of America. João Santos sorted everything out in an instant. His house was right near the club, on Campos Sales. He just had to cross the street. Perez was on America's sidewalk, the others inside in the hall, sitting in wicker chairs, conversing. First Perez, then Barata, then Avilar, Chinquinho, Ribas, and Osvaldinho. 24 players responded that they would play with Montiega. In the end, only 9 members of America, all players, some from the first team, others from the second and third teams, resigned. 5 Borgeses, 3 Curtis, and Paolo Viana. Dejalme Cortez, who was dating a Borges, did not resign. He distanced himself for a while from America, hoping that Montiega would leave so he could return, like Igas de Mendoza, fiancé of a Borges, and Matias Costa, married to a Borges. The Borges women were supporting their brothers, demanding their boyfriends, fiancés, and husbands to rally against Montiega. Montiega understood. He did not say anything, just stayed in his corner, in his place. He would enter the changing room and change his clothes quickly, only feeling comfortable on the field. The other players joked with him. Perez went so far as to slap him on the belly. They could take intimacies with him, but he would not take intimacies with anyone. He called everyone sir, removing his hat when anyone approached to speak with him. When a training session or game was over, Montiega found a way to leave with almost no one noticing. Jaime Barcelos was the one who would go after him. There was going to be a dinner at Filhos do Cio, and he could not miss it. Montiega promised he would attend. He would while away the time in Bandiera Plaza looking at movie posters. The others were probably already in the hall conversing. That was one place Montiega never entered, the Hall of America. He could pass by it at a distance, never having the courage to look at it. If he did, someone might see him, and if someone saw him, he would have to enter, or invent an excuse for not entering. It must have been nice to sit in one of those wicker chairs and have a little chat. Nice for the others, but not for him. Meanwhile, on the field, he had soaked his jersey for America to show that America was winning a little bit because of him. The game would end, and the fans of general admission would enter the field to carry Montiega in triumph. Everyone was yelling, America! And Montiega! Even the young woman of the grandstand. When he changed his clothes, however, he lost that assuredness. He was different in a suit jacket with a straw hat on. For so many years, he had worn a sailor's uniform and the uniform of a soccer player. In street clothes, he was uncomfortable, as if the clothes did not belong to him. He was soon filled with the desire to flee, to disappear. And no one on America wanted him to flee or disappear. João Santos went so far as to invite him to a cocktail party at his house, insisting that he come, not accepting excuses to show that he considered him to be just as worthy as the others. This was something that the Borgeses and the Curtis had always imagined as the greatest of absurdities, Manteiga at a cocktail party in Joao Santos's house at an elegant gathering with young women. For the Borgeses and the Curtis, the addition of Manteiga to the team should have brought an end to the cocktail parties, for if the other players went, why wouldn't Manteiga go? But Joao Santos took the opportunity to invite Manteiga to his first cocktail party, and there went Manteiga in his white Sunday suit to Joao Santos's house, all lit up. It even seemed as if there might be a dance, with the windows opened and adorned with young ladies. Outdoors, there was a group of America's fans, people from the barrier, on the sidewalk, peeking in. Manteiga would have preferred to stay on the sidewalk, far away. Joao Santos's house was for the other players, not for him. One could see that the other players had been there many times, looking like they felt at home. Manteiga did not lift his gentle, lamb-like eyes from the design on the carpet. One ended up feeling pity for his shyness as he hid himself away, afraid of meeting a Borges or a Curdy or someone like a Borges or a Curdy. Manteiga would never be comfortable at the cocktail parties of Joao Santos's house. He would, however, grow accustomed to the dinners at Filhos do Cio after training sessions and games, the tables pushed together, players of America all around with no young woman or anything else. And then he would always sit at Miranda's side. The two mulattos, who actually looked quite a lot alike. Like Manteiga, Miranda wanted nothing to do with America's hall or Joao Santos's house. After a training session or a game, Miranda would quickly dress himself and leave. Manteiga no longer left alone. He had found a good companion. He and Miranda understood each other well, as the two spoke the same language. The truth is that Manteiga felt like an intruder in America. It was no use for Joao Santos to invite him to his cocktail parties, for Perez to give him slaps on the belly. America was not for him. It was for the Borgeses, for the Curtis. Although it seemed as if he had won, America was at the top with him on its team, while Fluminense, with the Borgeses and the Curtis, was down at the bottom in last place. America was almost the champion. The Fluminense stadium was full to see the tiebreaker between America and Flamengo. Perhaps the Borgeses and the Curtis were in the grandstand. Or perhaps they were not, in order not to see Manteiga win. Manteiga never played with more desire to win, but when the game ended, the America fans did not enter the field to carry Manteiga in triumph. Instead, the Flamengo fans arrived to carry Nono in triumph. But Manteiga could have the satisfaction of seeing Fluminense, refuge of Borgeses and the Curtis, fighting off relegation against Villa Isabel. Even Marcos de Mendoza had to return in a hurry to save Fluminense. It was no longer the team of 1919, despite having Marcos, Laís, Fortes, Welfare, and Machado. But Fluminense remained in the first division, and after the game there was a victory dinner, a modest dinner, at Santo Antonio, an eatery at the back of a bodega in the Largo do Manchado, paid for by the players. Fluminense had nothing to do with the celebration, nor did Marcos de Mendoza. Even so, the players sang. They were not the songs of 1919, of Anna Amelia and Luis de Mendoza, but the songs of 1920 by Gerdal Bascoli. Fluminense has three teams. What colossal groups! Three tasty bone soups, difficult to bite. A sweet fruity juice is the first team. The championship far more than a dream. Like a divine offering, second team, a Brazilian side, from whom all try to hide. Even Paulo Viana sang, banging his glass on the table. Montiega forgotten, but the difference was vast between the South America Championship and a fine restaurant with a banquet hall and Santo Antonio, an eatery at the back of a bodega. The difference between 1919 and 1921. Although a team of whites had won the championship as before, as always, the whites were still on top, showing that America could get by without mulattoes or blacks. There were not just mulattoes and blacks in the empty lots in the small clubs. Flamengo had gone to seek out two players on Palmeiras, Nono and Orlando, without darkening the team, keeping it white. But America had signed a mulatto and had not contented themselves with one, seeking out another. With Nono and Orlando, Flamengo was champions. With Miranda and Montiega, America had lost. No one felt this more than Montiega. America was still deluding itself, thinking that Montiega would get used to the club. During the days that America spent in Salvador, right after the championship, Montiega seemed like a new man. He lost his shyness and did not flee from anyone. For Mario Newton, it was proof that habit was everything. It was a good thing for America, for Montiega, that time in Bahia. Mario Newton did not deny anything to Montiega. Montiega needed to know that America wanted the best for him. How could one not want the best for a player who gave them victories? Mario Newton had not even an inkling that Montiega was preparing to stay in Bahia. The clubs of Bahia were all over him, and he was making comparisons, remembering America's hall, João Santos's house, which were both strange to him. He would spend most of his time practically fleeing, appearing only at the time of a training session or a game. In Bahia, he was at home. It was also his home region, so wherever he went, he saw friends, and there was not even the shadow of a Borges or a Curti. When America packed its bags, the Bahia season having ended, Montiega asked Mario Newton to let him stay a few more days, as he had barely had time to see his mother, trapped in the hotel for the whole season. Mario Newton allowed it, and America left without Montiega.
Oof, thought my headset was misbehaving or doing whatever goofiness. Context of white supremacy. End of the second audio segment. It was a little bit shorter this time around, but oh well. We will pick up next week, just a minute or two. Anywho, the number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The email, untiljustice@gmail.com. No goofy spellings, all that. Untiljustice@gmail.com. We will get your commentary for the book. Let's see. I will say, now that we've read, I think, a legit third of this book, maybe a teaspoon more. I have to look to see where it officially ends. But we've read a good bit of this book now. I don't think this is that difficult. I mean, it's certainly not the easiest book I've ever read, but I don't think it's that difficult. The names, and it's got a lot of Portuguese, for sure. I've had to look up a few words, certainly not a Urugu, but even some of the times, the words that I've looked up, it's been not like a, oh my gosh, that is great, I've never seen that, but like physiognomy, yes, that was one for sure, but some of the others, I did know what they mean. I was looking them up just, you know, to make sure I didn't miss an understanding, that sort of thing. Not an, oh my gosh, this is the most difficult scholarly vocabulary, pedantic vocabulary. Like, no, not quite. I think if I had an 18-year-old, they were going to be going to college. I know, you know, their reading level and all of that. White teachers haven't terrorized them their whole academic career. They read, especially if they're into soccer. They think they might want to go to Brazil, learn a little Portuguese. I think an 18-year-old could read this book. They might, you know, pick up a few words. Great, that's what's supposed to happen when you read. But I think they could read this book. We've read more difficult, for sure. We have read more challenging books. Yorugu. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. I'll get in the rest of our previous person who wrote in. Rest of his written commentary. Let's see. I think we got that one. Number 10, page 97. Montega played for America. Started to wear a cap to hide his bad hair. More anti-blackness and examples of self-hatred by non-white victims. We've seen and heard that today and beyond just South America. Like if you are a non-white, I've even heard this from non-white people who have a white parent, where you have to make sure you keep your hair really close cropped, maybe even do totally shaved head. So they say, oh my God, he's got that devilish Negro kinky hair. That sort of thing. Number 11, page 98. Tattoo, South American champion 1922, was not white, quite dark, with thick curly hair. Mulatto and black players were, in the eyes of the finer clubs, a kind of illegal arms, like a revolver or a switchblade. I'm sorry for giggling. Like, man, I'm glad for 14-year anniversary, right? Invest, listener supported. That should be one thing. People have to itemize, like, all right, have we wasted our time 14 years? Like, have you just been on here talking madness, Catherine Pellinero, for a decade plus? One thing, words are important. I don't hear NPR or a whole lot of other programs consistently point out, man, be mindful of these metaphors, a la George Orwell, and that they transfer a lot of white supremacist values. At minimum, they are imprecise. But the values of white supremacy and anti-blackness, man, this passage would fit right in with Neely Fuller Jr.'s word guide. Avoid using terms such as dark, revolver, or switchblade when discussing non-white victims. As long as the global system of racism, white supremacy exists. I mean, like, really, how is a black person? I'd rather be called Gratum, right? If I got to be a switchblade or, like, never mind, just Gratum is fine. Gratum, I'll be all the Gratums. Yeah. I know my name is Gus, but Gratum is, yeah, I'll take that over. We got old Switchblade. Yeah. And democratization? I mean, yeah. Number 12. Vasco did not produce black players. Vasco, between a white and black player, similar quality, would stick with the white one. Black players recruited to help win. The club went looking for Nelson Chauffeur. Man, they are killing me with these names. Concacao, I think that is. I'm ignorant. I think this is Concacao. Concecao. Oof. Our narrator is killing it. His nickname even personifies that he is just part of the help for club Vasco. They mentioned in the first audio segment the prominent white player. They would go out for their clubs and all their rounds and everything, and they'd wait for the chauffeur to open the door. I was wondering, like, is that a black dude? Chauffeur? A la Sidney Poitier in Raisin in the Sun, where he works as a chauffeur for a rich white man in Chicago? Like, is that what's going on here? Or do they have white chauffeurs in Brazil? This time period, especially, even could a black person get a driver's license in South America at this time? Might not even have let niggers drive back then. I don't know. Let's see. Page 100. Fluminense had another stadium. America was building its own little stadium. The stadium's built for, this is his own commentary, the stadium's built for U.S. sports teams serve as drains on resources due to tax breaks, Negro removal, and for the most part, bringing nothing but harm to non-white victims. I wonder if similar things occurred as a result of these stadiums. I know, next week, that happened 2016 when Rio had the Olympics. That is exactly what do you call it? I don't know how you say that in Portuguese. Folks can look that up, but Negro removal, favela removal. Maybe that's how they call it. But you Negros are going to go further back into the hinterland. We got to put motels and hotels and resorts. Got to have fun. Got, you know, Kyrie Irving, old anti-Semite. I think he was in Rio for 2016. Like, yeah, we gotta make sure he's comfortable. You know, we gotta have fun. Make sure our athletes are taken care of. Old Simone Biles and everybody else. Get out of here. Ah, ah. Some things do not change. I'm gonna have to go back. That'll be for next week. But the Negro, at least the sports day. Now, I'm in Seattle. I think that is why the Supersonics are no longer here, because the white people say, yeah, these white ball teams, we don't need to subsidize every white ball club and have their $8 billion stadiums and be suffering. Unless it's going to be non-white people. Then, you know. Let's see. Number 14, national honor to defeat Vasco Jacobinism, pitting Brazilians against Portuguese. The Jacobins were a 1789 political club during the French Revolution who were noted for what is described as rabble-rousing radicalism. I know sometimes C.L.R. James, black male in the Caribbean, that's not really close to South America, not really, but his book is The Black Jacobins, and them applying that term to, I guess, rabble-rousing against black, white supremacy racism. That is a cowbell for C.L.R. James. Anywho, victim of racism. Anywho, black Jacobins. Read that on your own. We'll pause there, check in with some of the folks who dialed in. Let's see, folks who are with us, Lauren, caller at 2262. If you all have commentary to share, proceed.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am, Lauren.
Okay. On page 91, it said a mulatto player could be a Friedenrich, a black player could be a Gratum. Whoever might want to find a good player did not need to go far, just anywhere there was an empty lot. I guess the non-white people would be there. Brazil had many more mulattoes and blacks than Uruguay, and thus many more Friedenrichs and Gratums. Once in a while, someone would show up at a big club with the news that he had seen a Gratum. Some clubs would go to sea while others would not, wishing to win championships with whites, no Gratums. And the fans would put the pressure on. He's a Gratum. He looks like a Gratum. He plays like a Gratum, as in the case of Montiaga. It seems like they're using the word Gratum in as a synonym for nigger. It just, you know, he's a nigger. He looks like a nigger. He plays like a nigger. That's what it sounds like to me. And then later, it says, it was time for the championship to begin. Montiaga showed up at Campo Sale to train, entered the changing room, and Ivo Borges left immediately. With a Montiaga, he would not play. See, that also seems like another way to say nigger. They're just using the black player's name. Well, not say. It seems like the author is doing it. I don't know if people at that time did it. I'm not certain about that part. Later, page 91, it said the other big clubs still had an addiction
to white players. I don't really know what to make of that, but I did note it. And then, okay, it says, it was time for the championship to begin. Montega showed up. Oh, I said that part. Sorry. The other Borgeses and the Curtis left after him, followed by Paulo Viana, who was brown and had wavy hair that would make the young women envious. With Montega on the team, maybe they would look more at his hair. For that reason, Paulo Viana left all the more quickly. He did not want any trouble. I didn't even know what to make of that. And he describes males in a weirdly sexual manner. Later, it says, if America continued in this way, where would it stop? That made me think about the way white people discuss the southern border, about non-white people coming into the so-called United States. Hey, if America continues in this way, where is it going to stop? And I noticed another one of these nicknames. Paulo Cunha, known as the mother of Osni. He adopted Americano as well, traveling around with him in his red Fiat, the same Fiat that had brought Americano from Plaza Sete to General Severiano. I don't know why you will refer to a male as the mother of Osni. That's just super weird. But it's actually... getting to be a very common thing in this text. I too noted that part about the revolvers and the knives. The Borges women were supporting their brothers, demanding their boyfriends, fiancés, and husbands to rally against Montega. That part was important to me. Because they said the Borges women, but it's really the white women, were supporting the men in their lives and telling them not to play with a Negro. And when they were talking about Montega, or Montega, I'm not sure how to say it, the way he acted, that... it seemed actually kind of understandable. It said they could take intimacies with him, but he would not take intimacies with anyone. He called everyone sir, removing his hat when anyone approached to speak with him. When a training session or game was over, Montega found a way to leave with almost no one noticing. I think that's constructive behavior for then and now in the workplace. And later, Santos invites him to a cocktail party. I'm not sure if I would have went to that. And that's all I have for now.
Much obliged. I thought we heard that last week from a non-white player. I had to go back because I think I mentioned it. A non-white player with more of that drinking, fraternizing, and, oh, let's go out on a bender. I'm good. Did we hear that last week? Do you remember? If you don't remember, that's totally fine. But I feel like...
Yes, it was. It was the guy who had tuberculosis. He would not hang out with him. Everybody else was drinking. And he would just drink coffee and have his bread and butter. If that's... You know, I think that's what you're talking about.
Yep. I wish if I was better with these names, the Portuguese names, I would know it. But I mean, that hey, that's two people. Counter racist codification in the workplace. Mm-hmm. Got all these drunk white people. I'm cool. Hey, we won the chip. Come on, you gotta go. I'm cool. I don't know how you say that in Portuguese, but hey, game, recognize game, any time period, any country, any time zone, counter-racist logic, recognize counter-racist logic. I'm cool. Catch y'all next season. I'm going on all that. I'm going to miss the bender. Thank you. And they do refer to lots of males being referred to as females and the dandies and all the rest of it. That's come up throughout the book. We're not even halfway through. Like, man, what does that even say about white masculinity in Brazil, Latin America, South America? Other folks who dialed in with a hand up, did y'all have commentary?
No one saying anything. I just wanted to say the guy who had tuberculosis, his name was Montero, I think. And they did talk about his two sisters, but I don't think the book named him, named them. It hasn't really named any females, like you said, but I do remember the two sisters.
It's quick. It's no detail. It's no, oh, we can hang out with them and blah, 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 and at the game. And not a tidbit. I mean, it's just enough. The girls were at the gallery, looked up the skirts, and then we went back to the shindig. Like, it's where, I mean, gosh, like, no, I don't know if that's going to change as we have the so-called democratization, and we'll get some female characters that have you, but wow, it is, at the minimum, this is a super homosocial book. I don't, maybe he didn't even intend white women to read this book. I don't know. I will say that that is an enormous difference from the last two sports memoirs that we read, Bill Russell and Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, whose documentary, latest documentary was just released. Both of them, they talk about their mom, they talk about their wives and girlfriends and children in some cases. I mean, there are lots of named females recurring throughout conversations that we had, like, all throughout, even though I know these are no count toxic, privileged, sexist, misogynistic black males, Bill Russell and Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf. But I mean, hey, you have a lot more feminine energy, if you want to use that phrasing, in their memoirs than in this one. Anyway, let's see. Get to some of my notes from the second audio segment, which was not that long. I did want to say really quickly to the section, the first audio segment, when he talked about Gratum, and I totally agree with what Lauren said, that using this black male's name as like the word nigger or coon or whatever else, totally. But when they said that he and all the other black players, and I had to go back to make sure they said black players, they didn't say non-whites. So I guess maybe this doesn't apply to the mulattoes. You can't just go around kicking them however you want to, black kid back. But for the black players, they had to, you can't get mad, can't be kicking back and all the rest of it, because all the fans, they got their canes and they will be ready to come out and tear you to shreds. I suspect that that may have happened. How would you know that's what they were about to do? Like, you would have to have been there and seen, like, you would have to have seen this. Like, there is no comparison to that. You would have to have seen, there's no way anybody, even just the normal human response to playing a game and somebody hits you or whatever is, you know, hey, at least to give them a shove or whatever. Like, you would have to be conditioned based on what we have seen, what has taken place before. I think we got some saying that happens a lot where white people, and again, who is this written for? That probably took place. I mean, hey, you see what happens right now, them throwing bananas on the field and beating up people in the stands and all that. BBC even has documentaries with us on video at the soccer games and all of that. So, man, anyway, moving to audio segment two. This is the very beginning. where there could be anybody could be a greatum. Even that's kind of degrading. It could just be a good soccer player. And, oh, he's a greatum, a good nigra. There was anywhere there was an empty lot, like she, Lauren said, that's just automatically, you know, that's where the nigra urchins play. Brazil had many more mulattoes and blacks. Again, that's what I'm saying. They are disaggregate. That's something we should pay attention to, because that is so-called racial hierarchy. Black get back. The darker you are, the worse you are treated. I had to go back to double check to make sure when they said that about Graydon, he can't fight back. They didn't say non-white people. He didn't say mulattoes and black people. I don't think it was just the black players. No fighting back. You just take whatever they dole out. If they kick you and beat you down and all that, hey, go hide on the field somewhere. You know, mulattoes, maybe they could fight back. Here, he said they had more mulattoes. Brazil had many more mulattoes and blacks than Uruguay, and thus many more Friedrichs and Graydons in it. And it's repeated throughout the text. That sort of thing would make me think that it was probably widespread in terms of that's the way that people in Brazil talked, using Graydon like the word nigra. Oh, man, we got a bunch of them. I wonder if any of these Graydon boys are going to be good ones. Let's look through our new stock of Graydons. Let's see. Let's see. Stand up, Graydon. That's not a good one. All right, let's over here. Come here, Graydon. We're over there. We got a tall Graydon. Yeah, I suspect that's the way that they practiced racism with speech. And particularly because, I mean, names don't matter. We've seen that with the nicknames of some of the black players. Where one, the one black player was named Chauffeur. We'll see. And Johnson, that was from way back. I think that was like 2-3 weeks back when we read that one with the black guy after Jack Johnson. But, you know, genitalia. Let's see. Plays like Graydon. I think this is a lie. I said that before. He says he would not need to work much as long as he played well. He had already said before the contradictions. He had already said, well, said before some of these guys played well, but if they were black, they still had to catch the train. They still had to work putting all that toxic dye that could burn your skin and all that other stuff. In fact, he even had the pass where he said you wouldn't even know that they were on the soccer team because they were in working with the other factory workers, which is, that's what I said. All this just seems like some old sweatshop sharecropper type setup where we own the team and you got to do this, boy, whatever we tell you, boy. Let's see. You know how you say boy in Portuguese, figuring that out, too. The other big clubs still had an addiction to white players. Now, again, metaphor, that's like, you know, this is a habit? Like, a drug? Addiction to mistreating non-white people. That's just, I always think it's fascinating when that, and that metaphor specifically, white supremacy, racism as an addiction for white people, that is a worldwide metaphor. I'd even be curious, did he... That was the language, that was the phrasing in Portuguese when Fila wrote this out, addiction to white players. Let's see. He said the other Borges, again, the narrator is kill. I should get a better metaphor than killing it because she's not being violent. She is using her time and lovely voice in a constructive manner so that I don't have to butcher all of these names and do all the hard work of reading. But she is doing a phenomenal job, our narrator in Florida. I told her I was serious. I think she thought I was joking. I was serious. Like, Mr. Bolsonaro is in Florida. Like, man, if he is close, take a picture. Like, put that on social media. Like, hey, man, we are reading your country. Right? Give me selfie. Let's go. Get this on IG right now. And people are doing that. Like, I think I played the same. People are doing that. They're lining up, you know, out the house and all that. Anyway, the Borgeses and the Curtis left after him, followed by Paulo Viana, who was brown, black yet back, and had wavy hair that would make the young women envious. With Montega on the tee, maybe they would look more at his hair. Now, one, I said before, and when I say before, like even before today, I said the non-white players, and now I could be specific, like, ooh-wee, the non-white, non-black players, so-called mulattoes, they are emasculated. Specifically, they are effeminized. And he does it consistently with the hair, the dress, the descriptors. That's why he called them a dandy before. Now, I know this week he did use the term, he was talking about white people, but he used it before. He was talking about so-called mulatto players, and it was the same type of thing with their hair and all the rest of it. To be talking about a dude and to say this guy, Paulo Viana Brown, and had wavy hair that would make young women envious, like, is that a compliment? At the minimum, that's what they call a backhanded compliment, I think. I'm talking about a male, and his hair is so nice that these young ladies want hair like his. That's what you, is that how you talk about a man? With Montiega on the team, maybe they would look more at his hair. That'll distract from them being upset that we got these coons, Gratoms, on the, like, what? And this comes up again. Like, now this is one now, were they talking about the hair? Like, because this is not footnoted. So if during that time, the white spectators and whatever else, if they were talking about these players and that is a point of their opposition or ridicule of them, right? And I would appreciate a detail. Like, what were they saying? The nicknames and coal dust and all the rest of it. But man, like, and that is another one. Don't you tell me. People classified as white anywhere in the world are ignorant about racism. I think the phrase they'll use is race conscious. They don't pay attention to racial. Who does all of, no, let me look at what kind of hair texture you got. Oh, this is, look at the coils on, oh my goodness, he's got these Satan naps on his, oh, look at that. Who does all of that? He talked about skin complaint. Who does all of that? I got to get all up in your pallor and analyze the melanin concentration of your skin. We got to get a sample of his. Who does all? Individuals classified as white. That's who. All over the world, apparently. He said, the Borgeses and the Curtis only wanted America to understand this, and if not America, then Montega himself, like Americano. Americano had gone from Andra to Botafogo and ended up understanding, and he was someone with lighter skin who, with his hair straightened, could almost pass for mestizo. Now, that's pause, particularly for Brazil, these flipping racial classifications, that right there. So what are you even, I thought he was going to give us even the, he could almost pass for white, because mestizo is on the next line, right? So you get to the end of the line, you have to drop down. How he's going to say you could almost pass for white? No. What is mestizo? Come on. You just make up classifications every day. We got this and this and this and this and this and this. What does that mean? What is mestizo? How is that different from mulatto? Come on, man. They just make up slop on top of slop. At the end of the day, all of that means you're a Negro, someone to be mistreated. Now, like I said, black get black. So, hey, you are not Gratom Negro. So, you know, hey, maybe you can fight back. We won't kick you in the groin, the whole match and all the rest of it. But still, you are not white. We might even make up a new cool term for you. We won't call you a Negro or even mulatto. We'll be a mestizo-ish. Because they said he was almost. What does that even mean? Like, hi, you are almost. Could trick me into thinking you're mestizo. What? So I get to stay in the mulatto. Racial classification confusion. Octoroon, mestizo. Come on. Let's see. The mother of Ozni, she had talked that. How do you have all these dudes with these female names? To, like, the Yeah, I don't even know what you would call that, the masculinity, the white masculinity of South America and Brazil is something to study. Let's see. I think we heard that before as well. Like, dang, Montague understood. He did not say anything. We already talked about the codification, but even specifically, he would enter the changing room and change his clothes quickly, only feeling comfortable on the field. We heard that last week. Like, what the? How about the not changing with them? And I think I said last week, like, dang, is that because of all this homoeroticism in the book, or is that the racism? Like, is that I don't feel comfortable? I'm gonna wait and let you all do what you do, and then I'm gonna dash in, dash out. I'm out of here. I can't do the shindig. I'll catch you later. See you practice tomorrow. Or is that they are practicing? Hey, grade 'em. Get on out of here. Let us. We'll do our thing, and we'll let you know when you can shower last. I'd have to get more detail about the power dynamic of how that's operating. But this is something where Montega, if he understood, like, oh yeah, I'm cool for whatever reason. Their homoeroticism, the racism, a little bit of all of it, I'm cool. I'm gonna let you all do your thing. I'm gonna dash in and out and be gone. Counter-racist logic. Recognize counter-racist logic. Let's see. And we heard that. That is totally different from what Bill Russell said, right? Remember, he had that, I said that last week, he had that gay passage, because it was with the black player and the white player. They were in the shower together, and his dad came in, or his grandfather, I think it was the old man. He came, he's like, oh my gosh, they're showering together. I could almost cry on the rest of it. That was from way back. Anyway, I don't know if that'll be in the Netflix documentary. I'll pause there. Let's see. Well, anyway, we got to our 3 hour mark. For folks, if you called in and or wrote in and did not get to share, we are not even at the halfway point, so we will have ample time to continue studying, reading as we proceed. We will be here tomorrow, neutralizing workplace racism with some great suggestions that even came up in the book club today. Same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We'll be on every day, same time, including the big game, ball game, Sunday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Much obliged for everyone tuning in. Hope it was worthy of your Thursday evening. Sobriety would be best. You do not want to follow the example being set in this book, White Culture, drinking and drinking and drinking and drinking and drinking. They ate bad food. All we heard was horse meat and eggs. Ham and eggs and horse meat and drinking. Like, Jesus Christ. Like, y'all are not trying to promote healthy eating at all. Cholesterol. My God. Anyway, sobriety would be best. Drink more water. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No, man, we heard all kinds of name calling. This, they even turned a black person's legitimate name into an insult, a racist insult at that. Like, man, that has been modeled all over the world. No name calling. I've heard kunta used as an insult too. I've heard the exact. No gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Again, we are not making street urchins anywhere in the known universe. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.